All right, all right, all right, all right. It was the doo-doo-doo-doo-doo-doo-doo-doo-bees. Welcome to the Spicy Burrito Live on this special Holy Sabado edition. Spectacular. Tonight we've got Leisure Suit Larry Part 3, where we go through what better way to celebrate the Easter season than to, try to pick up chicks and hear a bunch of dirty fart jokes and vagina jokes. I guess that's a good way to celebrate Easter. And also, we're going to be talking about Jesus movies I watched from 7 p.m. last night up until 4 in the morning. I watched 5 Jesus epics, and I'm going to talk about them. So, yeah, that's what we're doing tonight. And so I didn't really have much time to set up this stream, so there's going to be no real crazy pictures and stuff and all the good slideshows you're used to, but we'll go through each one. These aren't my favorites. I just wanted to watch 5 Jesus movies and talk about them and tell you what I think about our Lord and Savior, Jesus Cristo. So Leisure Suit Larry, I don't know where we left off, and I didn't play ahead of time, so it's going to be all stuff. I don't know what's coming up, so I might have to be quick on the censor button, but that's fine. I do have it ready. I believe everything's said, audio, everything. So, yeah, I crammed in. And just one quick note, these Jesus movies, man, are they epics. I think the shortest one was 2 hours. The rest of them were all like 3.5, 4 hours. But the only criteria was Jesus had to be in it. Sorry, all my Jewish viewers there, all my Hebrew brethren. No Ten Commandments or any of those. They all had to have, Jesus had to make an appearance, I guess. That was the qualifier. I'm not going to rate these. I don't have, like, categories and stuff. Although, looking back on it, I probably should have if I had more time, but I didn't, so. Okay, well, without further ado, we should jump into the game. Now, I'm going to boot the game up on the fly here. And so I'm going to turn my headphones down because, if you remember correctly, I can't set the audio to this game until I get in it because the game's 25 years old or whatever, so. Pardon me if I don't talk here for a couple seconds. Oh, no. We'll get to that. We'll get to the nip factor. That's the reason why, looking back on it, I should have rated these because, I'll get to that later. Let's boot up Leisure Suit Larry Magna Cum Laude. And I'm not going to move it over to the game until I get this audio set. Okay. All right, that should be good. Let's go ahead and bring her up. Okay, it works. Nice, very nice. Very nice indeed. Let's see where we last left off. February 20th, we last played this. I must have saved 12:40 a.m. Has it been that long since we played Larry? I know I've been taking off a few weeks here and there. Barbara Jo Bimbo. I didn't know her last name was Bimbo. very nice. Very, very nice. Okay, so it looks like I am drunk. I am very drunk, both in the game and outside. I did have 3 glasses of rum before the stream, basically in the last hour. And I'm working on my last one, and then I'll switch over to beer. So, Larry's doing his happy dance. Well, I guess the first thing to do is take a piss here, huh? If I remember how to do that. There we go. Oh, shit. Unfortunately, that cost us all our confidence. Look at him walking like a dope. Oh, shit, yeah. Let's check out the audio situation. I don't know if it saves between game and game. I have this way down. Sound effects. Let's turn those down a bit too. And you guys let me know if you can't hear like the chat. That's the most important part of this game is like the conversations. Let's turn that way down too. So when we get into a conversation, just let me know and I can turn up some of it, I guess. if you can't hear it. But I got her cranked, so let's accept that and back out. Oh, wait, no, not back out of the game. There we go. Well, our confidence is shit, so let's play some whack-a-pole. Whack-a-pole, this is how you gain confidence, you jerk off. I love the injection gives you these giant hands. Oh, the penis pump. Oh, come on. There we go. Am I good at this game or what? Turn my vocals down. 20%, that's good enough for me. I don't want to play whack-a-pull again. You got to have your 30-minute cooldown period, right? All right. Let's go see what's happening in the world. Hello, Bill Zarbra. Hello. Hello, ladies. Yeah, Euro Trash. Bill Zarbra's Euro Trash.
Oi, you're such a mashugada.
Did you hear that? Oh, shit. Okay, let's get into the black book. If I remember, that's B. Yeah. What do we have? We have Beatrice. She's the one in the lab. I can't find the lab coat. You got to dress up like a scientist. So I can't talk to her yet. Tilly, please see me, Mr. Lovage. I am by the sorority, the Greek squad. Should we go check out Tilly, or we can go to Swingles and get the new set of girls? Oh, it's a wet t-shirt contest at Swingles. Okay, cool. Let's just check out and see if we can talk to Tilly. Let's go, Larry. Get her. Oh, speaking of Tilly. Go get her, Ray. Go get her, Ray. Yeah, Red. Okay. Let's mess up this guy's hacky thing. I gotta remember the controls on this one. Okay.
Library, that reminds.
Boo Cuckus.
Super token.
Big game coming up. Get your tickets now.
The fart button is my favorite. I only have eyes for you. Chick needs to eat a sandwich. Sorority, huh? That would be the big Pete. Oh, Bukakis. Holy shit. Where is she? She outside?
Maimon Maggots? What kind of...
That's not her. Harriet. Instead of you eating the sandwich off that broad, maybe you should give it to her. She needs to gain a few pounds. Oh, shit.
Oh,
is that
God.
Her, Tilly?
They
no.
They showed my favorite episode of the Family Pack yesterday. Watch out, Bulldaggers. This is our year.
Bulldaggers. There's fucking rabbits just roaming the halls.
I really need a new gimmick.
Tilly. Higgins.
I love sprinkles.
I'm checking the names on the doors. Maybe I can get into Tilly's room. Sandra. Vanessa. Mona. Hey, Mona. Yo, Mona. Who's the boss, Mona? Who's the boss? I don't see a Tilly around here. Oh, there we go. Duh. Go in.
Nothing in there. It's locked. Try again later. It's locked.
Hey, it's...
I didn't see her. So let's go to Swingles, I guess. It said, meet me at the sorority. Could she be outside the sorority? Well, those are just cheerleaders. There's a peephole.
Oh, a peephole. Wonder what's on the other side. Oh, a peephole.
I guess I can't do anything with it. Oh, there she is. This is the frat.
If we should align, Mr. Lovett, you really should look the part.
Nicer clothes. Where do I get nicer clothes is the question. Thar ye blow. That's like a sperm donation place, I guess.
I gotta return.
Can't go in. Walnut Logs' Chesty Turbo was one of the most famous rock groupies of the 60s and 70s.
Chesty Turbo. Oh, shit.
Okay, learn from my mistake. Kabuki and Bukkake may sound alike, but they're very different. So, it's illegal to show up at a public theater wearing only a towel. Nothing in there.
All right, let's talk to the Swingles lady.
Cabbage Head, back again?
Cabbage Head.
Yeah, what's going on here?
These girls are auditioning for the show with a little wet t-shirt contest, and you lucky boys are soaking them down in the next qualifying round.
Wet t-shirt contest?
Yeah, wasn't my idea. Anyway, you're gonna have to beat this guy. He's our current record holder.
Oh, God. What the hell is...
Russell. Miss Yasmin, please hand me my gun.
His lip sync's off a little bit. All right, Uma's giving you another chance to show the world your single Swingles material. You'll need to use your sharpshooting skills to get at least 7 girls wet. Don't let your water gun run dry, Tex. Oh, I am terrible. Come on, honey. Is that all? This is so stupid. Nice rack.
Oh!
Deadly aim. Are you going to pull that pistol or are you just going to whistle Dixie? All right, Toots, let's get over here. We ain't got all day. That was the dumbest side game ever. It was easier as shit, too. Baloney, Barb.
Swingles. This is it. It's time to prove whether you're a single or a swingle.
Now I'm both.
You're a real big man on campus, and that means you can hang with the creme de la creme in the power station's VIP room. It also means you can blow your wad at Fat Sam's Titty City.
I'm going there.
When they say anything goes, they mean anything. Now you're going to have to bag all three of these bras. Let's start with Barbara Joe. She's got all that Swingles Man looks for in a woman. Dumb, blonde, and a big fake rack. This is Morgan.
Oh, yes, Morgan. Brains,
beauty, and no hang-ups about public nudity.
No sir.
And finally, we've got Susie. It pains your game, this part-time dominatrix has it by the boatload. Swingles Man has to pay for it because his uptight Catholic wife won't come and whip him anymore. Finish line's in sight. Now get out there and be somebody.
Somebody, be somebody, be somebody. That's all of a fucking silencer on that cannon there. She's loading up to go kill some commies. All right. We got to go be somebody. Be somebody. I want to switch my outfit here. I should go around as a man. Let's get our standard gear on. Okay.
Man, I should.
Wasn't her.
Ugh, what a jerk.
I've got spirit. Yes, I do. I've got spirit.
We already banged
you?
That broad. Barbara Joe. Wasn't Barbara Joe the girl in the dorm room? The very first girl? Let's check her out. Morgan, that's the girl. We got to do that one tonight. We got to go after Morgan. All right, we'll check out Barbara Joe first, since she's the closest. Oh, Sally Mae. There's a difference. Oh, yeah. Do they still got Kurt Rambis's hits? Yeah, or Kurt Rambis's hits. Shit. Russell.
Russell, what the hell are you doing here? If you've come to apologize, forget it. You want to look like him? So what? What do I care? You're in love? You want to look like him so you'll win over the girl of your dreams, right? Oh, brother. All right, come on in.
Oh, shit. We're going to have to do a makeup game with this guy? Here we go. Russell needs your help. Maybe this is the way to bury the hatchet with him. As a button appears, hit it before it goes away. Make less than 5 mistakes to win. Yeah, I suck at these. What are the buttons? Up, down, left, right? If I remember correctly.
God, what have I done?
Wow. I got him 50? You got to get 50? Never going to happen. They're going to have to make this easy on me.
God, what have I done?
I'm hitting the buttons. See, it's doing this again. I remember. It's glitching. Totally glitching out. I'm hitting these buttons.
God, what have I done?
All right. Make it easier on me. So stupid.
Oh, I don't know. Maybe replace the soup can with a boot. What do you think? Here's a toothbrush, and you can keep that too, by the way. Taking the focus off your teeth should be our main goal. I've got some prescription deodorant here we should use. Watch behind the ears. Ditch the wrestling belt just for now, just for now.
The wrestling belt.
Castor oil for your halitosis.
All right, one more round.
Okay, let's polish that soup can.
There we go.
Brighten it up. Sometimes I even amaze myself.
Make those games so drawn out. He's in the Dumb and Dumber outfit.
Wow, Russell, you look great. Now, Russell, what do you say? Fuck me? Fuck you, you cousin-humping, sterno-drinking, cob-pipe-smoking... Oh, you're leaving? Yeah, well, you're welcome. Russell.
Okay. Russell! Are we in, like, Russell's room? What the... What is this Luba's room? I'm gonna have to purchase the nerdy outfit to talk to Morgan, I believe. Yeah, so... let's head out of here. Yeah, so I crammed in those Jesus movies, and they were all like 3.5 hours long. I was like, what the hell? I was like, this is never going to happen. Somehow I pulled it off and was able to set up the stream in the same, you know, before 8 o'clock. Oh, man. But it's not as involved as usual. But you know what? We got to get... I got the job done. That's all that matters. There was one movie I was thinking about watching. I think it was Jesus of Nazareth, but it's like, according to Amazon, it's like 6.5 hours long. I'm like, no. No, thank you. Fucking 6.5 hours. It's an Easter miracle. All right. Morgan, coffee. I would really use a cup of coffee. Hitchhiker's Guide to the Library. Okay, she's in the library and she needs a cup of coffee. So I'm going the exact wrong way. Let's head back. Although, I want to see if I can shop for nerdy clothes. I think you got to be in nerdy clothes. If I remember correctly, of course, it's been 20 years since I played this game. Do I got money? I do. I have tons of money. Sure. We'll purchase the makeup kit. I want to check out all the vendors and make sure they're not selling nerdy clothes. Wait a second. I already have that, don't I? No, I have some kind of suit. And then the preppy outfit. Luba, how you doing, Luba?
Yes, I do work out. Bah.
Okay, not here. Is this the gay club or is this just the dance club? I can't remember. I'll get copyright struck for, oh, me so horny. Oh, me so horny. YouTube will be like, you're having none of that. And I just laugh and go, I don't make any money off this anyways, YouTube, because I have 5 viewers. You guys have 1,000 viewers, though? I would have to fucking turn that shit off. That's the beauty of not having any viewers. Maybe Jesus will give me that. If I do him right tonight, maybe he'll give me that one, a random viewer. The rando. All right. We're allowed to go to Titty City, right?
It's locked. Fat Sam took his philosophy of customer first care and heavy discounting into the topless arena, and he hasn't looked back since.
Hey, ain't you the guy who got stuck in a bathroom window trying to skip out on your bar tab? Hey! Ain't you the guy who almost choked to death on that olive there one time, huh?
What the fuck? So they won't let me in there. Let's head into Plaid Mart. Maybe they got some outfits. Sweet Lou, how's it going? Baby oil. Again, no go.
Ah, need it.
Well, I've never seen that picture before. Ione. Where'd they come up with these names? There's a vending machine over here we'll check out too. Cool outfit. Do I own that? Let's back out and check. No, I don't. Cool. We'll grab it. Let's put it on. Oh, he's got a 5 o'clock shadow. He's the Fonz. Sit on it. Oh, shit. Oh, lefties. This is the original. You can see Uncle Larry in here. Does it say homie beef? Homie beef.
That's another thing. Why is it that all the scripts you sent me have the words car wash in the title?
We can get the bitching gloves. I don't want to spend all my money. I'll grab them. All right. Well, I gotta meet somebody. Where the hell are these girls? They just see me walk around checking vending machines all night. Yeah, that's a hell of a stream. Barbara Joe Bimbo. I don't know. Maybe I misread that. Tilly's. We can't talk to Tilly till we get the business outfit. So let's. She's at the sorority too. Morgan's in the library. Let's check out. Okay, we can hit two for one there. Oh, cool. It's like a big circle. That's nice. Speaking of commies, Zana. Can't talk to her. What's this guy? High quality bench. Yeah, thank you for spending your Easter Saturday. Holy Sabado. With the spicy fucking burrito. Ah, there she is. Finally. Of course.
Real spiffy, Larry. Put on something a bit less hideous.
I think we have the clothes to talk to her, though. Preppy?
She hissed at me.
We are not going anywhere with you dressed like that.
Huh. That's what I say to you, bitch. What a nightmare scenario where you need to find clothes, but you can't find where they sell them. It's like you think they make it real easy. You think a game like this should have made all the vendors carry all the stuff. I mean, what's the point of searching around? I mean, it's just... No, we need to go to the library.
Lost in the mail? How can you lose a 350-pound...
Venmaster 2000 used magical secret power for bringing you well lucky things. Enjoy in next always. Enjoy your pleasant with vigor. Venmaster is top of cool in world. Nothing, man. Nothing. That's brutal. I mean, all the vendors should carry all the outfits. There's no reason to have you... I mean, this game is not that involved to have you search around and search around and search around for outfits. I get what they're trying to do, but it's like... Oh, here we go. geek outfit. Wait, I... Hold on, I just want to check to make sure I don't have that. No, I don't. All right, cool.
Got out the June 84 issue of Assgasm, the April 93 issue of Top Heavy, the Teabag and Double Annual 96. I could continue, but this list is quite long. Somebody's been too busy.
Well, I don't have enough money to go with that one. Don't have enough money. Wait, I got $14. What is this? Five. Okay. Yeah, I guess I do have enough money. All right. Where is this, Morgan?
Bitch.
Yikes. She's going to say, you got to accessorize. How much you want
to
bet?
I have got to bum a smoke off somebody.
Not me.
Ma'am.
Yes.
I really use some coffee.
Oh, we got to go get you a coffee.
What is that all about?
Poindexter. There's a game here? Oh, you gotta be kidding me. Oh, why did I buy it? Why did I buy it? I didn't know a game would cost money. Now I gotta find a way to make money. See what I mean? This is like just like pulling teeth. I guess this is why I pre-played the game the last time. So I knew what to do right away. But where's the fun in that? Now I gotta find money.
Library, that reminds me. Well, I didn't.
Hey, Snowflake.
Yeah, that's not, I don't think that's how it works. I'll check. I think you gotta play a game where you mix her a coffee. I'm pretty sure. Because the coffee helps you out when you buy it from vending machines. Yeah. Oh, now you get it. Okay. Thanks for the tip. Just the tip. So, anybody know how to make money in this game? Besides finding it at random places.
One would be foot. Might I suggest this chaussure? The winged sandals of Hermes, the herald of the Olympian gods. We met in a support group for our various vices. His were sheep and goats. Mine is quarter horses.
The wings of Hermes. Did you grant me any money? The hell's the wings of Hermes? Def Leppard arm. I don't see anything that tells me how much money I have. Oh boy.
Cash.
There's $3. We're on our way.
Pardon me, but was your father an alien? Because there's nothing else on Earth like you.
Get the hell away from me.
Cool, found some cash.
All right.
Did you see Grabnoids last week?
It was on the Sci-Fi Network. I haven't seen it in so long.
He better return this to its rightful owner.
That's nine.
The American economy. What a waste. All they let you do with these computers is research.
Steve, what's up, my man?
You are an unsightly monstrosity.
Jeez.
Oh, no, that guy.
So, what time do you have to be back in heaven?
Please, leave us alone.
How much cash do I got?
Professor yet? She's
10.
Not, bro.
$10 measly dollars. Yeah, and then I keep forgetting about these 1920s load screens. Does this game give you money? Hold on.
I'm busy.
Sure, let's try it. Wonder if it gives you money. It's Tapper.
A protest?
Monkeys are people too.
Monkeys are funny.
Down with the system.
Monkeys like bananas.
Ah, shit.
Monkeys are funny, man.
I forgot you can run down the aisle, too.
All of us don't belong in cages.
Monkey power!
Fuck this guy. Take your paper and go. Of course, nobody's down there.
Free Leopold.
Monkeys are friendly.
Smoking monkey. I gotta see this.
Smoking monkey.
Bananas.
Monkeys are my friends.
A protest? I'm there. All of us don't belong in cages.
Yeah. Brutal. That doesn't even give you cash. That was a waste. Susie rocking out. She's playing some fucking VH. She got legs.
Me too. Freaking college kids.
She's gonna rock out with her box out. Bill Zarbra. What kind of name is Bill Zarbra? I still don't understand that. Is that a real name? Or is that some kind of pun I don't get? Like Philzarp?
Do you believe in love at first sight, or should I walk by you again?
What is it?
This is deep.
Yeah, that's what I was thinking. Philzarbra? Philzarbra? Philzarbra?
I suffer for my art.
Yeah, I don't know. I don't know. I don't know. They make it hard to find your outfits in this game, and they make it even harder to find money to buy outfits. It's just too much. It's like, this is supposed to be a comedy game. It's supposed to move along. It's not supposed to be, like, walking around looking for money. I know there's, like, activities you can do. I just don't know which ones they are. One's taking photos, but I don't understand how that works. Let's see if the commissar's got something for us.
Whoa, boy, let me tell you something. Sweet Lou, she the horniest woman I know. I hear she even got one of them D-Dos, sweet Lord. The commissar, he want himself a little bit of some of that. Will you give me a few pictures from my fantasy file? The commissar be your friend.
Take some hot shots of Sweet Lou. Oh, this is going to be good. Oh, I got to take hot shots of her ass.
Can't resist, can you? Hey, man, I'm on duty.
Oh, fuck. There we go. Come on, Lou. Show me the goods.
We got a security camera here. There's more where that came from.
Oh, she's so sexy.
Yeah, that ain't all.
I can never get like the high priced ones.
There's more where that came from.
All right. No.
Yeah, that ain't all. Hey, man, I'm on duty.
So dumb.
Can't resist, can you?
See, I can only get the yellow. It makes no sense.
We got
security camera here. There's more where that came from.
I'm stuck on something. This is the dumbest fucking game ever. Let me through, you fat bitch.
Hey, man, I'm on duty.
Oh, my God. So all I have to do is get in her face. We're not doing that again. That's... Oof. You ever want to rage quit something? This is definitely it.
Party! Ah-hoo!
Let's go.
Yeah. It's definitely frustrating. I've tried the cheerleader thing. It doesn't work. You can't get any... can't get any good pictures. All right. Well, I'm going to have to bring up tonight's topic. I'm already an hour deep, and I haven't done one thing in this game. That's kind of frustrating. But let me, when it loads up, I'll pause, and let's bring up the first movie. I mean, that's cheer me up. Maybe it's Jesus' way of telling me not to play porno games. Oh, shit. Did I check these bushes? You know what? I never checked the art gallery. Maybe I can find some money in there. Beatrice.
My nails are looking raggedy.
Secret token! Woohoo!
No, I don't want secret tokens. I want money.
I really should go to the store and pick up some.
A secret token! If you were a laser, you'd be set on stunning.
Beat it, jerk.
Neo-cubist Andres Hume.
All right.
I love sprinkles.
Look at these lemmings.
Yeah, what a nightmare. Okay, I'm going to have to load up that topic there. Whew. Does that meet the game too? Oh, cool. All right, let's bring up tonight's topic for the Holy Sabado, Easter, Sabado, Sabado Easter Spectacular. The first movie I watched was The Greatest Story Ever Told. This was a long one. This was like 3.5 hours freaking long too. And it was, I was pleasantly surprised at how good this movie is. I've never seen it before. I've seen a lot of the Jesus movies out there. This one I've never seen before. The premise is basically Jesus's life from start to finish. And it's like word for word. This is like, if you want a deep dive into the Gospels and telling it basically like scene for scene, for verse from verse, this is the one you want to go to. A lot of the Jesus movies seem to focus on one aspect of his life, whether it be the crucifixion, whether it be the resurrection, whether it be the birth. This one just tells the whole kit and caboodle. You get everything in this one. Very good. All the teachings, all the miracles, all the politics. It's just a total epic. telling of Jesus's life from start to finish. And like I said, it's almost word for word. Now, Jesus is played by Max von Sydow, who is probably one of my favorite characters in The Exorcist. He plays the priest in The Exorcist. Yeah. And he's also in the Star Wars, the Force Awakens for like 5 minutes. But Max von Sydow, he's freaking awesome. He plays the way they shot this, like, Jesus is so unemotional. He's almost like a block of wood. Like, he doesn't show any emotion. He doesn't get excited. He doesn't smile. He just says all the stuff he says in the book, in the Bible. So, I don't know if they did this. I assume they did this so when he does something, when he does show emotion, it adds to the shock value or the surprise value of it. Like, he goes through the whole movie and doesn't show any emotions, and then when he gets crucified, he starts, he's being tortured, so he does show emotion. It makes it even that more shocking. Or, like, throughout the first half of the movie ends with him raising Lazarus from the dead. Well, if you remember the story, Jesus wept at Lazarus' funeral. So, like, the first time you see him show any emotion is, like, an hour and a half into this freaking movie, and one single tear comes to his eye. And it makes it that more profound, I think. And I think that's what they're going for, obviously. A great part of this movie is the man, the myth, the legend, Donald fucking Pleasance plays they list him as the Dark Hermit / Satan. And he does a fucking great job. I love Donald Pleasance. From my Halloween 2 review I did, and when I did a horror movie sequels, Donald Pleasance is freaking awesome. And he does a great freaking job. He plays this hermit that just tempts Jesus throughout the movie. And then he shows up in random spots throughout the movie. Like, he's the one that comes in when Jesus is on trial, and he gets the crowd to start chanting for crucifixion. He just walks up and then he's everywhere. He's in the background, and it's freaking cool how they used him. He's not like some big demon or some, he's just an old hermit, you know? And his biggest scene is when he's tempting Jesus in the desert, which is pretty good. He's like, "You must be hungry," and he tries to feed him. And so yeah, and it's played by of course Donald fucking Pleasance. Now, I read a quick fun fact that Max von Sydow. Oh, that's what it was. Okay, we'll get to that in a second. Let's see. As far as this movie goes, there is some weird, weird shots in this movie. Like, they do a lot of this overhead, like, the camera's way out. Like, you got this big, huge room, and the camera's up in the corner, and there's actual dialogue going on between the characters, and there's no close-ups. It's, like, filmed from way back then. It's, like, I compare it to, like, Skycam from the NFL, you know? It's, like, why the fuck are they putting the camera way back there and not zooming in on the characters while they're giving dialogue? It does that a lot. And the whole crucifixion scene is done like that. Like, literally, the camera's, like, a football field away, and they show the crucifixion going on from that far away. It's, like, crazy. I don't know what they were thinking on that. Let's see. And the first half of this movie, I said, ends with Lazarus' resurrection. And it's really cool ending to the first half of the movie, because he resurrects Lazarus, and then all the people are, they start playing Hallelujah, the song Hallelujah, Hallelujah, whatever, you know it. And all the people that witnessed Lazarus raised from the dead fucking run into Jerusalem to spread the word, and then Jesus gets on his donkey and goes into Jerusalem. It's very profound with the Hallelujah orchestra or chorus or whatever, choir going on, and they're all running, and they're like, "Hey, we're gonna spread the good word," and you know how Jesus' story goes. Everybody's happy to see him in Jerusalem, and then 7 days later they want him crucified, so or 5 days later. So yeah, the Last Supper, in this one they depict the Last Supper like Leonardo depicts it, and it reminds me of that fucking joke what did Jesus say at the Last Supper? He said, hey, guys, get on this side of the table. You want to be in the picture, right? So they're all at a table, but no, they're not sitting around the table. They're all sitting on one side. That kind of cracked me up because it looks just like Leonardo's. You can tell that they wanted to shoot it like Leonardo's Last Supper. I believe it's Leonardo who painted that, right? Yeah, I'm pretty sure. Telly Savalas. Now, here we go. Telly Savalas plays Pontius Pilate, which, you know, they hired a Dago actor to play a Dago, you know, Pontius Pilate, who loves your baby. Hey, Jesus, who loves your baby? And no, he did not have a lollipop, sans lollipop. Yeah, Kojak. Ooh, anyways, so this brings me back to my earlier point I was about to bring up. I believe Telly Savalas, Max von Sydow, and Donald Pleasance, a fun bit of trivia, they all played a version of Blofeld from the James Bond movies. That is correct, right? I know Telly Savalas did, and I know Donald Pleasance did, and I'm pretty sure Max von Sydow did too. In Never Say Never Again. So, yeah, I thought that was pretty freaking crazy. They're all in this movie, and then they all play the same character in three different James Bond movies. So that was pretty fucking cool piece of trivia. I mentioned Telly Savalas. Let's move on to the other stars. There's a lot of stars in this epic. Chuck Heston, of course. Charles fucking Heston plays John the Baptist. Now, this is probably the weirdest interpretation of John the Baptist I have seen. They portray him like he's fucking Captain Caveman. Like he wears like a buffalo pelt or something. He's not even like, it's like a big hairy caveman pelt, just like Captain Caveman. And he acts like a brute, and he acts like, I don't know. It was just kind of weird. It was definitely a different interpretation of John the Baptist that I've seen. Yeah, John the Baptist screams like a wild man, but he shouldn't act like a total caveman, you know? Like he's something out of the Planet of the Apes. It was like they took Chuck from Planet of the Apes and put him in the Jesus movie. So, another star in this movie, Jamie Farr. Now, he plays Thaddeus, I believe, which is one of the apostles, I believe. And no, he does not wear a dress and high heels. Hey, Jesus, can I get a Section 8? I want out of this. I want out of your ministry here. No, he doesn't wear it, but he has like one line. And I think he says, I'm Thaddeus and this is my brother or something like that. But every once in a while you see Jamie Farr's big old schnoz sticking out in the background, you know. Maybe he should have wore his Mudhens jerseys in this movie. Jamie Farr. Let's see. Any other facts? Yeah. I did mention the crucifixion is shot from afar, which was really weird. Usually they want that stuff in your face. And we'll see later when I get to a later movie how in your face it can actually get. The second half of this movie. Now, the first half is slow. And it seems like they go through every little detail of the gospel. But then it's like they crank it up to 11 in the second half and speed it up. Now, I read on IMDb that they wanted to shorten this movie and they had to edit like a half an hour of footage out and stuff. So they probably took it out of the second half. It does seem very sped up, which is, I guess, unfortunate. That extra half hour. I mean, you're already invested in 3.5 hours. What's another half an hour? You know what I mean? So why not just make it 4 and tell it right or tell it proper so it doesn't seem so jarring when you watch the second half of this movie. I was never ever really bored in this movie. There is some slow parts, but it's just a good deep dive telling of Jesus's life. And there's a lot of stuff I forgot from childhood, you know, that this movie reminded me of or made me recall. Another funny celebrity, there's a one-line cameo by John Wayne in this fucking movie. And I think he says that after Christ dies, he's like, he truly is the Son of Man. And he does it in his John Wayne fucking voice, you know? And that's all. And they don't do a close-up of John Wayne. It's like shot from, like I said, 50 yards back. But you could tell it's John Wayne. You could tell it's his voice. Holy shit. I thought that was pretty cool to, you know, have John Wayne just give a one-line cameo. I mean, the guy was probably the biggest star of the day. I forget what year this was. This might have been the late 50s. It is a very old movie. And in fact, I couldn't even read the credits. They're so bad. Like, the color scheme of the credits in the beginning and the font they used, it's just, you can't even read it. It's like, oh, it's brutal. They really accentuate Max von Sydow's freaking eyes, though, in this movie. And I noticed that his eyes are like, I don't know, you know that Technicolor feel when stuff is like really bright, like Wizard of Oz? Max von Sydow has these bright blue eyes, and it just seems out of place. And I read on IMDb as well that they did something with his eyes where the director shot this movie and cut out every time Max von Sydow blinked. So, like, he didn't want Jesus to blink at all in this movie, which is crazy. And if you watch it, I believe there's a couple times he blinks, but most of the time his eyes are just wide open. It's pretty crazy. And it's pretty cool, you know, to look into the eyes of, I guess that's what he was going for, to have show the emotion through his eyes or whatever. But it really works. They're bright blue Technicolor eyes too. So in conclusion, like I said, if you want a good retelling of Jesus's full life from birth, pre-birth, actually, it starts with Herod and the prophecies, and the three kings come in and visit with the elder Herod, not the actual Herod that put Christ to, or that put Christ on trial. It was actually his father, Herod, or another Herod. Anyways, and they go through the, I forgot about this, they go through the whole Herod sends out soldiers to kill everybody's infant child at the time because he doesn't want the prophecy to be foretold, or he's heard of this prophecy and he's afraid that this guy's going to overthrow him. So he kills every infant he can find in Galilee or the whole, and Bethlehem or the whole area that he controls. So it does go into that, which you don't see in a lot of Jesus movies. But yeah, overall, my recommendation is pretty high on this one. It's pretty good. It isn't time investment, and I would rather spend my time watching Gettysburg than watching this movie. I can get more from other Jesus movies, but if you want a retelling of his life from start to finish, or actually pre-birth to finish, this one's good. It does not really go into his resurrection. I think he gets resurrected, but that's it. It doesn't go into Acts of the Apostles or anything after the resurrection. So, I recommend it if you want a refreshing history of Jesus' full life. Watch The Greatest Story Ever Told. And it also gets a nip factor 0, I believe. Not even breastfeeding nips. So, nip factor 0 on that one. But it's a good movie. I probably won't watch it again for another 15 years. Because, you know, growing up in a Catholic education, I know all those stories. I don't need to see them again. I would rather focus in on something different about Jesus' life or some different kind of way of telling it. But like I said, that's pretty good. So that is the first one down. And my clock, I can't see because I put the notes in front of it. Hold on. 9:15. Okay. Well, let's go back to struggling, looking for money in this stupid freaking game. The quest for more cash. And, you know, just a heads up. These I said it at the beginning, but anybody that tuned in lately, these aren't my favorite Jesus movies. I just picked 5 random ones that I wanted to, watch. If I had to do it over, I probably should have watched Jesus of Nazareth. I guess that gets more praise, no pun intended. But that movie is 6 hours long, according to Amazon. I didn't know that. But I did not have the time to invest 6 hours in it.
I need another drink.
All right, so we're going to run down and try to take some pictures of some cheerleaders, I guess. Let's see if we can do anything with this. also tried to pick different kinds of movies. That was the one, like the original epic that I picked. And then I the next one you'll see is a different kind of way of telling the story and all that. So, all right, picture time, ladies. Show me what you got. Yeah, see? I mean, what can you do here?
Oh, yeah, get fired up! Go, go! Fleming. Damn it, Hillary, get it together!
Well, should we take one and see how much we can sell it for? Why'd you guys stop? What, I fart?
I am so not in the you. I am so not speaking for this. You.
Oh, what if we take it from behind?
You too.
Commissar, get out of the way.
I am not speaking to you.
All right, let's sell these. Maybe he'll give me a few bucks. Wait, I gotta pay a valuation fee? Come on. $20. What does that mean? I don't. I don't know. All right.
Deck game?
Yeah. Those guys are like totally.
Did he just give me $20? Hold on, did he just give me 20 bucks? There's no way you can. There's no way you can tell how much money you got. This is so dumb. Okay, how do I, trying to buy coffee, right? So maybe that costs $15 to play. Maybe I'll be able to play now. Yeah, there's some very glaring design flaws in this fucking game. That's all right, though. I love it. I love it. It's just, it's kind of annoying. Especially when you're doing this on live. I should have played earlier and built up some money or something. This is my biggest fear, doing nothing in a game for 4 hours. I do have 20 bucks. Awesome. Okay, so next time we need money, just take a bunch of shitty pictures. Yeah, I got it. Yeah, I got it. You're behind. Or I'm behind you, or whatever. There's a delay. That's just what I wanted to see on Easter Eve. Bunch of dildos.
What's checked out to my library?
All right, let's see me fail at this one. Hello, Morgan. Finally, we get to talk to a woman. I pushed it.
Sloppy. No one will notice.
Yeah, there's something up with the actual. So we got to fail at this 3 times before we can play again. Better not cost. Oh, you got to be kidding me. Wow. What a complete joke. So I'm going to need $45. Because I got to play it three times. And they won't even make it easier. So I don't know if I'm going to be able to play this. I'm pushing those buttons and it's totally not registering or something. Oh, boy. Can we just turn this off and play Subnautica? Oh, yeah, I need 15 for the other one. Well, ugh. And that's if they'll even let me do that, if they'll even make it easier on me.
I am not speaking for this. You.
I hate you. I hate you.
I am so not in the mood for this.
I hate you.
I am not speaking to you.
Oh, but it costs 6 to evaluate. Oh, shit. Oh, no, it'll evaluate him. Okay.
On deck game?
All right, let's do it again.
I am so not in the mood for this.
Way to cheese the game here. I only made $5. $11? That was going to take forever.
Power station is so passe.
I am so not speaking for this.
You.
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 You
need to fuck alone.
You better believe I am.
I don't know. I don't know. And I don't even know where the bartender diploma was. I don't remember.
I am not speaking to you. I am not speaking to you. I am not speaking to you. I am not speaking to you.
I am not speaking for that.
You.
I am not speaking for that.
You.
Notice this.
Almost there. Almost there. We're getting there.
This campus has got all these weird.
I am not speaking to you.
I just don't know how you would get a better picture.
I am so not speaking for this.
You.
I am so not in the mood for this.
I am so
not in the mood for this.
I am so not speaking for this.
You.
One more, one more.
On deck game.
I am so not speaking for
you.
Fuck
alone. I hate you. I hate you. I hate you.
Leave me the fuck alone. Leave me the fuck alone. I hate you. I hate you. 64.
If I am.
You know what? I'm going to do one more round so I can buy the diploma.
I am so not speaking for this.
You.
I am so not speaking for this.
You.
I am so not in the mood for this.
All right, that should be enough. Leave me the fuck alone. Larry's got diarrhea. an hour and a half in, haven't done one thing in this game yet. Ugh, makes you want to blow your fucking brains out. Who's this? She's a plant? Oh, artsy girl. The bartender diploma will make the game easier, won't it? If I have 70-some dollars, let's hope it costs less than 10.
What's checked out to my library card?
Bar diploma. 10, 73 would be 63. We're doing it. I think this will make the game easier. But that's not the problem with the game. The problem is the input. Like, it's not registering until I play the easy version. It's the weirdest thing.
A little sloppy. Maybe no one will notice.
Wow.
A little sloppy.
I hit that one. I hit that one.
Almost. Maybe no one will notice.
Yes, please. See, now it works.
Okay, here we go.
55 of these fucking things.
Nicely done. All right, not bad. Nicely done.
How much shit are you gonna put in this coffee, Larry?
Okay,
just put her slipper a Mickey
go.
And be done with it.
Nicely done. All right, not bad.
More sugar.
Nicely done. Well done.
Boom. Fucking perfect, you cocksmoke.
Perfect.
Fucking game. Eat it, game. Eat it. See, now I'm not going to be confident enough to talk to her. We have to go play whack-a-pole.
Yes, I am a bud.
Where are you, Morgan? You're in the second story, aren't you?
Look, guys dressed like you don't talk to girls like me. It's just not done.
Oh, boy. I hate this game.
Who I can't believe him.
All right, so who had the nerdy outfits? Was it the library? He might have had them.
Stop it!
I need the calculator watch. Cost 10. Can we do it now, honey?
Did I douche?
Did I?
Sorry, I'm in my offended state right now, so I can't talk to you.
Oh, you fucking pain in the ass. Women.
I was wondering, did a pair of plate metal gauntlets show up in the Lost and Found?
And I'm telling you once again, no.
I need $2. Give me my $2! You gotta be kidding me. Give me my $2. Off to take more pictures. Yeah, I think this might be the last time I play Leisure Suit Larry live on the air.
I am so not in the mood for this.
More respect, Joelle.
I am so not in the mood for this. I am so not in the mood for this. You. I am so not in the mood for this. You.
On deck game.
Give me my $2. Coco, beware. Fucking struggle fest. Wow. If I do play this game off camera, I'm making $1,000. I'm going to take pictures for 5 hours. I'll do it too. Make $1,000. And then buy every fucking outfit and every accessory I can find. All right.
What's checked out to my library card?
Yeah, give me the pocket protector, please. Is that everything? Let me just check with him before I fucking leave.
April 93 issue of Top Heavy, the Teabag and Double Annual 96.
Oh no. You got to be kidding me.
This list is quite long. Somebody's been pretty busy.
I need the thick glasses too.
I have got to bum a smoke off somebody.
Get your own. Not even gonna bother.
I could use a new strap-on.
I'll be watching.
Better return this to a rightful owner, like a hawk.
Oh my economy. God, I lucked out there. Was like, give me the final fucking thing. Dildo, and he was like really gross and hairy. Let's just make sure we got everything. All right, we got everything. All right. All right, you prude. You better talk to me now.
Nobody understands my art.
Sorry, I'm in my...
Coolest of all nerds. Who wouldn't want a girl who plays video games? I'll tell you what. A girl who knows her way around Skyrim knows her way around my heart.
Oh, what a predicament I'm in. I have here 2 choco mocha cream lattes. Yet there's only one of me. If only someone would aid me in this horrible predicament.
Did you say choco mocha cream latte? Yeah, I'll take it off your hands. Those are, like, my favorite.
Really? It's good to find a woman who shares my refined tastes. You know, this morning I was at home reading, and as I poured through my much dog-eared copy of The Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy, I...
Really? That's my favorite book.
No, it's your second favorite. But don't get the impression that I'm some bookish sort. You know, with pocket protectors and chess clubs who never gets laid. I also spend time with my other interests, eating blueberry cereal and buying Dukes of Hazzard lunchboxes off eBay.
Okay, that's a bit too familiar. Do I know you?
Probably. Hey, you want to go somewhere and talk about it? And have sex?
Okay. I don't know. You don't seem too weird, but isn't this a bit sudden? I don't know if I could hang out with someone who I only know in real life.
Shouldn't we IM or MORPG a little first?
I know. We could dress up like plumbers and have a picnic in the old sewer tunnels. I'm getting a wee bit hot just thinking about it.
What? I just did that last week. How do you even know about those tunnels?
It's like I've known you all my life. We both lost our virginity to Scotty Peters. Our favorite fruit is the kumquat.
Have you been reading my website?
Web? What? What do you... Who? What? Okay, look, I may have stumbled onto it once, and maybe it was because I heard that you sometimes left your webcam on while you were changing. But after a few weeks of waiting for that to happen again, I started to come back because you gave out details of your sex life. I think we've bonded in ways I never could with a girl who knows I exist.
Wow. I have my own creepy stalker fanboy.
Is that so wrong?
I thought creepy stalker kind of summed up my opinion on that.
Maybe I shouldn't fart so much when I'm playing her.
Oh, what a predicament I'm in. I have here two choco mocha cream lattes. Yet there's only one of me. If only someone would aid me in this horrible predicament.
Did you say choco mocha cream latte? Yeah, I'll take it off your hands. Those are, like, my favorite.
I know. It's good to find a woman who shares my refined tastes. You know, this morning I was at home reading, and as I poured through my much dog-eared copy of The Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy, I...
Really? That's my favorite book.
Why, yes it is. But don't get the impression that I'm some bookish sort. You know, with pocket protectors and chess clubs who never gets laid. I also pretend to have other interests. Eating blueberry cereal and buying Dukes of Hazzard lunchboxes off eBay.
Okay, that's a bit too familiar. Do I know you?
Probably. Hey, you want to go somewhere and talk about it? Like a date?
A date? I don't know. You don't seem too weird, but isn't this a bit sudden? I don't know if I could hang out with someone who I only know in real life. Shouldn't we IM or MORPG a little first?
I know. We could sneak down to the library sub-basement.
That was a wet one, Larry.
Explore each other's bodies while we explore the sewer tunnels. It could be quite an adventure.
What? I just did that last week. How do you even know about those tunnels?
It's like I've known you all my life. We both have a crush on Bondre the Giant. Our favorite fruit is the kumquat.
Have you been reading my website?
Web? What? What do you... Who? What? Okay, look, I may have spent over 48 hours straight staring at it. And maybe it was because I heard that you sometimes left your webcam on while you were changing. But after a few weeks of waiting for that to happen again, I started to come back because you gave out details of your sex life. I think we've bonded in ways I never could with a girl who knows I exist.
Wow. I have my own creepy stalker fanboy.
You think I'm some creepy pervert?
I thought creepy stalker kind of summed up my opinion on that.
Oh, what a predicament I'm in. I have here two choco mocha cream lattes. Yet there's only one of me. If only someone would aid me in this horrible predicament.
Did you say choco mocha cream latte? Yeah, I'll take it off your hands. Those are, like, my favorite.
Really? It's good to find a woman who shares my refined tastes. You know, this morning I was at home reading, and as I poured through my much dog-eared copy of The Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy, I...
Really? That's my favorite book.
No, it's your second favorite. But don't get the impression that I'm some bookish sort who does nothing but read all day long. I also spend time with my other interests, eating blueberry cereal and buying Dukes of Hazzard lunchboxes off eBay.
Okay, that's a bit too familiar. Do I know you?
Carnally? Not yet. So, you, me, some sweet lovin', interested, and, have sex?
A date? I don't know. You don't seem too weird, but isn't this a bit sudden? I don't know if I could hang out with someone who I only know in real life. Shouldn't we IM or MORPG a little first?
I know. We could sneak down to the library sub-basement and explore each other's bodies
there
while we explore the sewer tunnels. I'm getting
a wee bit
hot just thinking about it.
What? I just did that last week. How do you even know about those tunnels?
It's like I've known you all my life. We both lost our virginity to Scotty Peters. Our favorite fruit is George Michael.
Have you been on my website?
Do you really think I'd use my computer for something other than porn? Hello? Okay, look, I may have stumbled onto it once, and maybe it was because I heard that you sometimes left your webcam on while you were changing, but even after I realized that was Luba's website I was thinking of, I started to come back because I really liked reading what you wrote. I feel like you're the sister I never had incest with.
Wow.
Oh my god.
I am my own creepy stalker fanboy.
You think I'm some creepy pervert?
I thought creepy stalker kind of summed up my opinion on that.
All right, should we go for four times? Well, let's do it. World's most boring stream ever.
Oh, what a predicament I'm in. I have here two choco mocha cream lattes. Yet there's only one of me. If only someone would aid me in this horrible predicament.
Did you say choco mocha cream latte? Yeah, I'll take it off your hands. Those are, like, my favorite.
Really? It's good to find a woman who shares my refined tastes. You know, this morning I was at home reading, and as I poured through my much dog-eared copy of The
Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy,
Really? That's my favorite book.
Why, yes it is. But don't get the impression that I'm some bookish sort who does nothing but read all day long. I also spend time with my other interests, eating blueberry cereal.
Dukes
of
Hazzard
lunchboxes off eBay.
Okay, that's a bit too familiar. Do I know you?
Carnally? Not yet. Hey, you want to go somewhere and talk about it? And, have sex?
A date? I don't know. You don't seem too weird, but isn't this a bit sudden? I don't know if I could hang out with someone who I only know in real life. Shouldn't we IM or MORPG a little first?
I know. We could sneak down to the library sub-basement and have a picnic in the old sewer tunnels. It could be quite an adventure.
What? I just did that last week. How do you even know about those tunnels?
It's like I've known you all my life. We both lost our virginity to Scotty Peters. Our favorite fruit is the kumquat.
Have you been reading my website?
Web? What? Okay, look, I may have stumbled onto it once, and maybe it was because I heard that you sometimes left your webcam on while you were changing, but after a few weeks of waiting for that to happen again, I started to come back because I really liked reading what you wrote. I feel like
you gotta be shitting me.
Wow. I have my own creepy stalker fanboy.
Is that so wrong?
Oh, thank
you. Kinda. But I guess it's sorta cute. At least you have the balls to ask me out. All my guy friends want to bang me, but they're too scared to even ask.
Uh-oh. We're going to play some D&D. Oh, come.
Oh, wow. Is that a Bondra?
I can't even
control
them.
I think so. You know, I keep telling the janitor to stop putting up posters in my room.
I used to have such a crush on him as a kid. After my dad took me to WrestleMania, I wrote Morgan Loves Bondra like a million times on my Trapper Keeper.
Really? My grandpa always said he had a dream where he was a peanut vendor, and he went into the shower there, and he said Bondra the Giant's wiener was only like 3 inches long.
If your grandfather was a peanut vendor, what was he doing in the wrestler's locker room?
Okay, when I say peanut vendor, you need to look for the double meaning, okay?
Anyway. Did you know Bondra was over 7 feet tall?
He was a little taller than me, and he weighed more than my Aunt Mabel. See, he had a really bad eating problem. A rare disease that makes you really tall and big and kick a lot.
You sure know a lot about Bondra the Giant.
I should. See, me and Bondra are best friends.
Don't you mean were?
No, we still are. I'll call him on the phone right now. Yeah, Andretta, is your daddy home? Oh, you and Bulk Bogan are wrestling right now, huh?
Bulk Bogan.
Tell the Bulkster I accept his apology for that time he got mad that I was so much cooler than him. He's telling Bulk Bogan what I said. Bogan sounds really turned on.
If you'd like to like to make a call.
Oh, really? That's nice, Bondre the Giant.
I think you're my best friend, too.
Well, gotta go. Bye.
Larry, I hate to break it to you, but Bondre the Giant's been dead for like 10 years.
That's a lie! Then who has my mom been spending all that time with?
Oh, I don't know. No one?
How about I just call Bondre the Giant back and tell him he's dead? I bet he'd fly here on his giant plane and throw a big rock at your head.
Come on, Larry. It's not like I'd fall for that sad little trick anyway, even if he was alive.
Trick? Oh, you thought I was trying to trick you?
My mother warned me about dating losers. Why didn't I listen?
This game's harder than, like, fucking... I don't know. Survival mode on fucking Skyrim.
Oh, wow. Is that a Bondre the Giant poster?
I think so. Well, it was up here when I moved in.
I used to have such a crush on him as a kid. After my dad took me to WrestleMania, I wrote Morgan loves Bondre like a million times on my Trapper Keeper.
Really? My grandpa, he was a peanut vendor at WrestleMania 4, and he was invited to the cast party after, and he said Bondre the Giant's wiener was like a foot long.
If your grandfather was a peanut vendor, what was he doing in the wrestler's locker room?
My mom said I wasn't supposed to talk about it with anybody outside the family.
Anyway... Did you know Bondre was over 7 feet tall?
7'2", and he weighed more than my Aunt Mabel. See, he had a really bad eating problem.
I can't do it.
That makes
I can't
you really
do
tall
it.
And big and kick a lot.
You sure know a lot about Bondre the Giant.
I should. See, me and Bondre are best friends.
Don't you mean were?
No, we still are. I'll call him on the phone right now. Yeah, Andretta, is your daddy home? Oh, you and Bulk Bogan are wrestling right now, huh? Tell the Bulkster I'm sorry for kicking his wimpy butt last year. He's telling Bulk Bogan you like him. Bogan sounds really mad.
If you'd like to make a call...
Oh, really? That's nice, Bondre the Giant.
I think you're my best friend, too.
I've got a lady caller.
It won't move
Bye.
Down.
Larry, I hate to break it to you, but Bondre the Giant's been dead for like 10 years.
That's a lie! Then who has my mom been spending all that time with?
Oh, I don't know. No one?
How about I just call Bondre the Giant back and tell him you called him a nobody? I bet he'd take the first flight over here and deliver a big boot to the back of your head personally.
Come on, Larry. It's not like I'd fall for that sad little trick anyway, even if he was alive.
Really? I thought it was working.
My mother warned me about dating losers. Why
yeah,
didn't I listen?
I'm a total fucking loser. This game. Oh. Can you make it easier on me now? Nope.
Oh, wow. Is that a Bondre the Giant poster?
I think so. Well, it was up here when I moved in.
I used to have such a crush on him as a kid. After my dad took me to WrestleMania, I wrote Morgan loves Bondre like a million times on my Trapper Keeper.
Really? My grandpa, he was a peanut vendor at WrestleMania 4, and he and Bondre really hit it off. And he said Bondre the Giant's wiener was only like 3 inches long.
If your grandfather was a peanut vendor, what was he doing in the wrestler's locker room?
My mom said I wasn't supposed to talk about it with anybody outside the family.
Anyway... Did you know Bondre was over 7 feet tall?
7'2", 540 pounds. See, he had a really bad eating problem. A rare disease that makes you really tall and big and kick a lot.
You sure know a lot about Bondre the Giant.
I should. See, me and Bondre are best friends.
Don't you mean were?
Oh, yeah, I do. I'll call him on the phone right now. Yeah, Andretta, is your daddy home? Oh, you and Bulk Bogan are wrestling right now, huh? Tell the Bulkster I accept his apology for that time he got mad that I was so much cooler than him. He's telling Bulk Bogan what I said. Bogan sounds really mad.
If you'd like to make a call...
Oh, really? That's nice, Bondre the Giant.
I think you're my best friend, too.
Well, gotta go. Bye.
Larry, I hate to break it to you, but Bondre the Giant's been dead for like 10 years.
Oh, yeah? Then who was I talking to on the phone?
Oh, I don't know. No one?
How about I just call Bondre the Giant back and tell him
Damn
he's
it.
Over 7 feet tall? I bet he'd take the first flight over here and show you just where he puts his peanuts.
Come on, Larry. It's not like I'd fall for that sad little trick anyway, even if he was alive.
Trick? Oh, you thought I was trying to trick you?
Wow. You really are stupid, aren't you?
Oh, well. What? Yeah, I think this might be it for old Larry.
Oh, wow. Is that a Bondra the Giant poster?
They just make it way too freaking hard.
Well, it was up here when I moved in.
I used to have such a crush on
him
as a kid.
For a comedy game.
After my dad took me to WrestleMania, I wrote Morgan Loves Bondra.
Like that. I hit that every fucking time.
Really? My grandpa, he was a peanut vendor at WrestleMania 4, and he and Bondra really hit it off. And he said Bondra the Giant's wiener was like a foot long.
If your grandfather was a peanut vendor, what was he doing in the wrestler's locker room?
My mom said I wasn't supposed to talk about it with anybody outside the family.
Anyway. Did you know Bondra was over 7 feet tall?
7'2", 540 pounds. See, he suffered from acromegaly, a rare disease that results in an overabundance of growth hormones.
You sure know a lot about Bondra the Giant.
I should. See, me and Bondra are best friends.
Don't you mean were?
Could you get your daddy on the phone?
Are. I'll call him on the phone right now. Hello, Bondra the Giant. This is Larry.
Oh, you and Bulk Bogan are wrestling right now,
Bulk
huh?
Bulk Bogan.
Tell the Bulkster I'm sorry for kicking his wimpy butt last year.
He's telling Bulk Bogan what I said. Bogan sounds really mad.
If you'd like to make a call...
Oh, really? That's nice, Bondra the Giant. I think you're my best friend, too. Well, gotta go. Bye.
Larry, I hate to break it to you, but Bondra the Giant's been dead for like 10 years.
Oh, yeah? Then who was I talking to on the phone?
Oh, I don't know. No one?
How about I just call Bondra the Giant back and tell him you called him a nobody?
I bet he'd take the first flight over here and deliver a big boot to the back of your head personally.
Come on, Larry. It's not like I'd fall for that sad little trick anyway, even if he was alive.
Trick? Oh, you thought I was trying to trick you?
You know, it's really cute how you go out of your way to impress me. I think you're ready. There's something I'd like to try with you.
Uh-oh. Twister? The space button powers up your meter before you strike. Oh, the slaps game?
Damn, you're good. Where's luck? This one.
Oh, you bitch.
Count. Wow, you suck. Worst game ever. Not feeling very competitive today, are we? Worst game ever. Wow, you suck.
Woohoo! Yeah, certainly do. Oh, come on. So much for the censored sign. I had her beat, too.
Did you really
what the fuck? She does that to me all the time.
Worst game ever. ever. Nice one. Did you really just do that? Curses. Foiled again. Close doesn't count.
Bullshit.
Not feeling very competitive today.
So much for the eyes.
Damn, you're good. Did you really just do that?
She dodges every one of mine.
Wow, you suck. Nice one. Stings a bit.
Nice call.
Ouchie. Did you really just
put
that?
Your hands down.
Worst game ever. Curses. Foiled again. Ow! Stings a bit. Close
no, no, no,
count.
No, no, no. I didn't hit.
Feeling very competitive today, are we? Warrior is about to die. Where's luck? Did you really just do that? Nice one. Damn, you're good. Damn, you're good. Did you really just do that? Wow, you suck. Not feeling very competitive today, are we?
No, it's bullshit.
Worst game ever. Damn, you're good. Damn, you're good. Curses. Foiled again.
Come on, Larry. You can do it. You can do it, fucker.
Did you really just do that?
What the hell just happened?
Wow, you suck.
Nice boobies.
Competitive today, are we? Come back anytime and I'll beat you again.
Oh my god, I hit her with the normal without flinching. Go figure. Gotcha.
Nice one. I let you win that one.
Nice push.
So you rolled a 13, which is enough to hit.
Beaver Slayer. That's what I name my sword. Does 1v8 plus against dorks, so I do 9 damage.
Oh, that's enough to take out the last orc. The princess calls for you to save her.
Sweet. I check out her, equipment. Is she cute?
Yeah. Her charisma is 17, so I guess she's cute.
I stare at her chest a bit. Verily, thou art hot. Did it hurt when you fell from Valhalla?
Okay, I'll need a charisma check to see how well you do. Oh, that's not good. But her int is only 5, so she doesn't notice.
So, does she, like me?
No. She says, oh, you must save me, good sir knight. The evil wizard will be back soon.
Gotcha covered. I whip out my rod. Stroking.
Larry, it's striking, not stroking. Whatever. No, he's too powerful. You'll never stop his virgin sacrifice.
Virgin, what a wonderful word. Hey, what say we fix this virgin problem of yours?
Well, I guess that'd break the spell, and the demons would take him instead.
I have a boner. If we're going to die, at least we can go out the good way. Taketh off all thine clothes.
What?
If you're not a virgin, he can't sacrifice you.
She's not sure how to react. Ooh, just barely made it. She rips off her chainmail bikini and leaps into your arms, topless.
Great. So we have sweet, sweet sex and...
Nah, I'm not gonna let you get off that easy. What exactly do you do?
Well, I get on top of her and rummage around for her G-spot.
Okay, that's a -4 penalty for no foreplay, but +2 for her superior sluttiness feat. Oh, a critical hit. She's humping your leg.
Wow, I love this game. I hump back.
Dexterity check. And you don't have the right skill, so... you miss.
You hit her elbow. She takes one damage.
Okay, this time I cast Mordenkai Sure Shot first.
Good idea. Your penis emits an eerie blue light and you get a +8 bonus. Okay, you're in.
I ride her like a war horse. Is she done yet?
If you have to ask. Okay, constitution check. Sorry, you lose it early. That's gonna be a -4 on future reaction rolls.
Why would that be a minus? We stopped the sacrifice?
No, nope. She casts dispel magic on herself and reveals that she was really the evil wizard all along. You just fucked the villain.
Wah, wah, wah. Man, the missing floppies.
So you rolled a 13, which is enough to hit.
My two-handed sword of girth does 1d10 plus 3 against loins, so I do 9 damage.
Oh, that's enough to take out the last orc. Princess calls for you to save her.
Cool, I go up to her. Is she cute?
Yeah, her charisma is 17, so I guess she's cute.
I stare at her chest a bit.
Hey, baby. What's a nice wench like you doing in a rotten dungeon like this?
Okay, I'll need a charisma check to see how well you do. Oh, that's not good. But her int is only 5, so she doesn't notice.
Five? Not even trying. I can't do anything.
We're soulmates.
No. She says, oh, you must save me, good sir knight. The evil wizard will be back soon.
Gotcha covered. I whip out my +5 rod of stroking.
Larry, it's striking, not stroking. Whatever. No, he's too powerful. You'll never stop his virgin sacrifice.
Virgin, what a wonderful word. So wait, if he can't sacrifice you, what happens?
Well, I guess that'd break the spell, and the demons would take him instead.
Demons? Yikes! It might not work, but at least it will be fun. My squire is ready to come out.
What?
If you're not a virgin, you won't be pure anymore.
She's not sure how to react. Ooh, you just barely made it. She rips off her chainmail bikini and leaps into your arms, topless.
Great. So at least my fictional versions get some and...
Nah, I'm not gonna let you get off that easy. What exactly do you do?
I mount my fair wench and feel her royal boobies.
That's a -4 penalty for no foreplay.
Oh, shit.
But +2 for her superior sluttiness feat. Oh, a critical hit. She's humping your leg.
Okay, I mount her and thrust.
Dexterity check. And you don't have the right skill, so... you miss. You hit her elbow. She takes 1 damage.
Okay, this time I cast Cure Minor Erection first.
Good idea. Your penis emits an eerie blue light, and you get a +8 bonus. Okay, you're in.
I ride her like a war horse. Is she done yet?
If you have to ask. Okay, constitution check. Sorry. That's gonna be a -4 on future reaction rolls.
But we did it, right? We stopped the sacrifice?
Nope. So she casts dispel magic on herself and reveals that she was really the evil old wizard all along. You just fucked the villain.
I get it. No, I want it easier. You have to go through these 4 times.
So you rolled a 13, which is enough to hit.
My two-handed sword of girth does 1d10 plus 3 against loins, so I do 9 damage.
Oh, that's enough to take out the last orc. Princess calls for
it's
you
over.
To save her.
As soon as you hit those 2
cool.
drinks, the sperm
is
doesn't
she
move.
Cute?
Yeah.
Like
her
it should.
Charisma is 17, so I guess she's cute.
I stare
Look
at
that.
Her chest a bit.
Hey, baby. What's a nice wench like you doing in a rotten dungeon like this?
Okay, I'll need a charisma check to see how well you do. Oh, that's not good. But her int is only 5, so she doesn't notice.
So, does she, like me?
No. She says, oh, you must save me, good sir knight. The evil wizard will be back soon.
No problem. I whip out my +5 rod of stroking.
Larry, it's striking, not stroking. Whatever. No, he's too powerful. You'll never stop his virgin sacrifice.
Wait? Virgin sacrifice? So wait, if he can't sacrifice you, what happens?
Well, I guess that'd break the spell, and the demons would take him instead.
I have an idea. If we're going
Fuck.
To die, at least we can go out the good way. Get thee ready for some man cream.
What?
If you're not a virgin, you won't be pure anymore.
She's not sure how to react. Ooh, just barely made it. She rips off her chainmail bikini and leaps into your arms, topless.
Great. So I finally get to use that chainmail condom I spent all my gold pieces on and...
Nah, I'm not gonna let you get off that easy. What exactly do you do?
I mount my fair wench and feel her royal boobies.
Okay, that's a -4 penalty for no foreplay, but +2 for her superior sluttiness feat. Oh, a critical hit. She's humping your leg.
Okay, I mount her and thrust.
Dexterity check. And you don't have the right skill, so... you miss. You hit her elbow. She takes 1 damage.
Okay, this time I cast Mordenkai Sure Shot first.
Good idea. Your penis emits an eerie blue light and you get a +8 bonus. Okay, you're in.
I ride her like a war horse. Is she done yet?
If you have to ask. Okay. Constitution check. Sorry. That's going to be a -4 on future reaction rolls.
Why would that be a minus?
So unfair.
I'm a man now.
Nope. She pulls off her mask and reveals that she was really a master assassin all along. You just fucked your murderer.
Awesome. This is riveting. They're not going to give it to me again. No, I'm done. Fuck you.
I'm going back to the library. I'll catch you later.
Yeah, fuck you. Oh, boy. Okay, well, this game is a total dud. Yeah, I think this will be the last time we play this game. I just can't be playing the same mini game over and over again. It's just annoying. So, let's bring up the topic. Maybe try some other broad next time. All right. We're way behind. Two is a movie called Risen. I think it came out in 2016 or 17 or something like that. Let me crack a beer here. I need one after this freaking stream, this fucking game. This is a very interesting movie. I remember watching it on Netflix back when it came out or whatever. It's very interesting because it's like a Roman detective story. I'm always big into all the Jesus movies. I'm always big into how the Romans are, you know. I love Roman history and stuff like that. So this is kind of like a Roman detective story. And the premise of the movie is Joseph Fiennes' character, he's a tribune, and Pontius Pilate tasks him with ending the crucifixion, just speeding it up because I don't know why. Jesus won't die or whatever on the cross. So he goes there and tells them to, you know, break everybody's legs on the crosses and stuff. Just speed up the process and get him buried. And so he goes and does that. And then he puts two guys in charge of watching over the tomb. And, of course, Jesus resurrects and the tomb's busted open. And what ensues is, like, his investigation, at least for the first through half of the movie. Is his investigation. It's really interesting because the things he comes up with that are like alternate explanations than Jesus rose from the dead, and all the evidence, all the alternate explanations and stuff. And basically it's a race against time because what they believe, well, first of all, let's put it this way. They believe that there was grave robbers, that his apostles stole his body. So, that people will think he resurrected and it'll catch on and word will spread. So he's tasked to find out what happened and where Jesus' body is. And they need to find out before word starts to spread and this Jesus rose from the dead stuff catches on. And it's pretty interesting and it's pretty thrilling. And it's pretty cool to see the explanations he comes up with. Yeah, like it's a race against time. That's what I have in my notes. He's like, Joseph finds, thank God it wasn't, I think his brother is Ralph, Rafe finds. Thank God it wasn't, because I don't know how to pronounce his first name. Joseph finds is the Tribune. He's like this, he's hell-bent on finding the answers. He's like a detective, you know? And around halfway through the movie, or a little over halfway through the movie, he witnesses or finds the apostles that are locked in the attic, and Jesus appears to him, and he's just like, wow, you know, this guy is literally resurrected from the dead. So he follows Jesus and the apostles at a safe distance. He doesn't, like, you know, bother him, and then, you know, eventually they take him in, and his faith takes over. And he's no longer looking for answers. He's a man of faith, and he comes to the realization that Jesus did resurrect from the dead. And he becomes like the apostles' bodyguard, like the Romans are hunting him down, and he saves them and stuff like that. It's a very, very cool movie. I don't think it got any box office success or whatever success. In fact, it's probably really under the radar. I don't know if many people heard of this movie, but it's very cool. Let's see. Jesus. Now, I mentioned that Jesus' portrayal in The Greatest Story Ever Told was kind of like stoic or non-emotional, or no emotion and stuff like that. This one, the Jesus in this movie is like smiling and happy and playing, having fun with the apostles and stuff. And he's always smiling. And he looks more like Jesus. He's not a blonde-haired, blue-eyed, you know, Swedish guy. He's actually, I know I've seen the guy before who plays Jesus in this movie. He's in a lot of stuff, but he looks Middle Eastern. So they got that interpretation of Jesus probably correct from what historians think Jesus actually looked like. But like it's a total 180. Like he's smiling and stuff. And I wonder if that has to do with the fact that this movie. Story is more about the resurrection and the ascension of Jesus to heaven than anything that happened in his life. I mean, they show the crucifixion, he's already up on the cross when the movie begins. They don't show any nails going through or anything. I don't believe, I didn't pay attention that close, but the crucifixion is almost done. I mean, it's just him dying on the cross at the beginning. And it goes into like the Acts of the Apostles and stuff, how Jesus appeared to him, how he's going to send the Spirit, Holy Spirit to him and stuff like that. And that's a different perspective than a lot of these Jesus movies that I've seen over my whole life. You don't really get much from the resurrection and beyond. You get more of the crucifixion or his ministry or his childhood or whatever, you know. So that's, it makes it interesting. Also, the politics in the Romans, I'm always, like I said, I always like curious about the Romans and how they're portrayed and the politics between him and Pilate and then him and his right-hand man and how that all works out. The interminglings of all that is very good. The ending of this movie could use a little help. I didn't really care for it. I mean, what's crazy is like the Romans are after Joseph Fiennes' character, his goal in life changes. He's no longer trying to solve the mystery. He's helping out the apostles and stuff. They're still chasing after him, the Romans, trying to find Jesus so they can prove to everybody that he's not resurrected. At the end of the movie, Pilate just gives up. He just gives up. I forget what he says, but it's like, the Tribune, Joseph finds his character, you know, has a faith conversion and all that. And he walks away after Jesus ascends into heaven. He walks away and starts telling people this story, or some innkeeper his story and stuff. And he gives up his life as a Tribune, obviously. But then they pan to Herod, or not Herod, Pilate. And Pilate's like, well, that's the last we'll hear of him. And it's like over. He's like, you're not going to keep trying, you know, to find the apostles and stuff like that. I don't know. It just seemed a little weird. It seemed like a little rush, like they were just like, end it. So let's just have Pilate say, yeah, it's over. And some of the lessons or things in this movie, which I like, are one of the main, I don't know. I don't want to say lessons of this movie because it's not really teaching you anything. The one thing I just noticed is like the apostles are, you know, teaching them and having them carry on the word is one thing, but converting like a Roman tribune who prays to his own god, Mars, or one of his gods, Mars, throughout the movie is a much bigger task than converting people that already believed in you, obviously. I just thought it was pretty cool to see how they played that off, you know, like they show how religious Joseph Fiennes' character is to Mars and the Roman gods, and to see a conversion take place was actually really interesting. But yeah, so Risen is a very good movie, very underrated. I didn't think I would like it at first, but I watched it and I liked it, and then I've watched it just last night, and yeah, it's a very good movie. So if you're looking for something, a different perspective on the resurrection, this is the movie for you. I highly recommend it. No nip factor in this one, though, so maybe that'll turn you off or not. I don't know. Unless you want to see, Joseph Fiennes' nips, I guess. I don't think he has nips. But yeah, if you want to see something from the Romans' perspective and as far as the resurrection and the ascension goes, this is a good movie. And like I said, there's not many movies out there that deal with that. As far as I know, I'm sure I could find a lot of documentaries and a lot of History Channel bullshit going on there. But to see it in movie Hollywood form is very, very, very cool. So, I recommend Risen very much so. Where are we at here? We're at 10:30. Oh, shit. Do I even want to play this game anymore? I don't know. Well, I guess we will. We'll jump back into it. Are you sure you want to quit? No. We'll try something else. I just can't do it anymore. Beatrice, I got to find the Greek squad. Where is Barbara? Did we ever find Barbara? She's supposedly at the sorority, but I checked the sorority, and she wasn't there. So how about Susie? The VIP room. I don't think we're getting in the VIP room.
Oi, you're such a mashugada.
Funny, she doesn't look Jewish.
Oi, you're such a mashugada.
Yeah, so I gotta buy preppy clothes. So another thing I gotta buy.
A secret token.
There is a difficulty. I gotta buy accessories for the preppy clothes. Where do I find those? That's, you know, I don't wanna check every vendor every 5 minutes. Difficulty. Can we lower it? There's the adaptive. Yeah, you can't even lower it. All right. Now he walks all slow because I have no confidence. So it's not at that vending machine. Luba.
What's checked out to my library card?
Beeper. Okay. I got $2. Yeah, no, I was thinking of a couple things. You know, in Lent, during Lent, you're supposed to make a sacrifice during Lent. I guess it's to be with Jesus and recognize his ultimate sacrifice for us all. Well, you know, the Catholic Church, the sacrifice is don't eat meat on Friday. And I always thought, like, here we got Jesus who gave up his life, got crucified, whipped, crucified, beat, you know, beat up. And our sacrifice is don't eat meat on Fridays. So, oh, God, I got to get fish or peanut butter and jelly, you know. Some big sacrifice we're doing there. Shit. I remember one, there was one Lent where
I hate you.
Gave up meat for the whole Lent, you know. It was back when I was in college.
Not in the mood for this.
I hate you.
Back when I was in college, so I gave up meat for a whole month. All I ate was bean burritos and Caesar's. Well, first of all I ate was bean burritos from Taco Bell.
Those guys are
and
totally
Caesar salads from Boston Market. Oh, shit. And then I just had diarrhea for a month straight, basically.
Maggots?
Bean burritos. It's the only thing I could find that didn't have meat.
I am so not speaking to you.
I didn't shit solid for a week. That happened to me once. I fucking diarrhea for a whole week once. What the hell? I was back in college.
I should be in class right now.
Too much fucking blats and schlitz. And Pabst and Grolsch. And High Life. I hope my epileptic viewers aren't getting, you know, crazy by that flash on that camera.
You better be.
We're going to do it one more time.
I am so not speaking for this.
You.
Whoa. The game programs every time you take a picture of a girl this, for one of the girls to say, leave me the fuck alone. All right.
Weird alleyways and stuff.
Let's go by, what did we need? Was it the preppy... for Barbara, and we got the sweater. Okay. Babs. I should have played Whack-A-Pole before I left. It's the only game I'm good at. I wonder if I could... I'll have to test it out within the next month. I wonder if I can get a controller for this game. Maybe. I think the analog sticks would be so much easier than the up and down keys on the computer, on the keyboard. It's made for that, for the feel of that. Like, you can't halfway push the up and down keys. You know what I mean? You can't halfway push it like you can halfway push an analog stick. I think that's where I'm going wrong, or why it's so hard to control.
What's checked out to my library?
This game
card
was not meant for PC. I gotta give him credit for trying, but...
It says you got out the June 84 issue of Askgasm, the April 93 issue of Top Heavy, the Teabag and Double Annual 96. I could continue, but this list is quite long. Somebody's been pretty busy.
A visor. Awesome. He's ready to go play some fucking golf. 18. Look at him. Fucking, I'd sulk too like that if I had to wear that shit. Is that it? Let's just make sure. Yeah, that's it. Yeah, I would definitely, I definitely give him, I got to give him credit for putting this on PC, but it just doesn't work. And I'm starting to realize the only reason I got through the first two nights of this is because it was a, the first two levels of this game, but then it just launches up, rockets up there in difficulty, and it's just not made for it. Now, if I can get a controller to work for it, though, we could be back in business. Let's go struggle with this broad. Not little Susie's on the what? I guess probably why nobody's watching, because they don't want to sit here and listen to me bitch about how hard this game is all night long. But it's so frustrating, you know? All you want to do is play a comedy game and have fun with it. And they want you to, like, fucking be a master keyboardist. Going to the Mohawk Tech game. All right, bitch. I'm dressed. Now I won't be confident enough to talk to her. There'll be some other prerequisite to fucking talk to this broad. Yeah, Risen's a really good movie, though. Check it out if you haven't seen
it. Get away.
She said, it'll get away. That's not a good sign. Fills her, bruh. All right, be good to me, game.
Ooga! Babes ahoy! Check out the gazangas on this one.
Gazangas.
Yeah, I noticed.
Who's in charge here? All right, time to play it cool. Act real smooth. Now we need an opening line. Ask her for her autograph.
What, are you serious?
Just say it.
Can I have your autograph?
Why?
All right, tell the broad you thought she was Miss America.
You are Miss America, aren't you?
Well, I was a semi-finalist for Majestic Little Miss Mendocino 1988.
Bingo!
I don't know, maybe you remember me from the football games?
You play football?
Are you serious? You're killing me here!
No, I'm a cheerleader.
I used to be a cheerleader in high school, and then one day I was assaulted in the parking lot by the team captain, and he said, I'm not the team captain. I'm Frank Hannon's father. But if you'd like to come back to my place, my wife's out of town.
Jesus, Mary, and Joseph, all right, move it on over. I'm taking control of this vessel.
Yeah, right. Anyway, like, you don't even know my name.
You got a name, little girl?
And why should I tell you?
Wowie, wow, wow, this kitten's got claws. You're a real barn burner, kid. Anybody ever tell you that?
I don't think so.
I don't care what you think. Heck, I don't care if you think. You are one ripe tomato. Why don't you meet me around 7 outside the VD clinic? I gotta pick up some Condocel cream.
Yeah, that's great. Good luck with that. I'll be with my boyfriend, Chet, tonight.
That schmo from Kokomo that works at that Ricky Tick rub joint on Bob Balaban Boulevard? Let me wake you, kid.
Bob Balaban Boulevard.
Stick with me, baby. I'm a real king bee.
Yeah, and why should I go anywhere with you?
What's the matter? You afraid you might like it?
No, I know I'm not gonna like it.
Hey, don't knock it till you tried it twice.
All right. So, like, I do admit this might be good. Well, that was funny. Half, but I'm calling the shots.
You snap the whip, I'll take the trip.
Bob Balaban Boulevard. That was pretty funny. Don't knock it till you tried it twice. Oh my god, I passed the game.
Let me show you why cheerleaders are simply a jump above the rest.
Oh, we don't want to play this drunk. Boing.
Up, up. Down, left, up.
Up, up. Up.
Right, right. Up. Down, left, down.
Yeah, it's doing the same thing.
Up, up, down, left, up.
up. Left up.
Right, right up. Down. Left down.
Right up. Down. Down.
Up, up, down, left, up.
Up, up, down, left, up.
Right, right, up, down, left, down.
Right.
I should put the camera on my finger so you guys don't know I'm bullshitting you.
Up, up, down, left, up.
Up, up,
right,
up.
Right, right, up, down, left, down.
Right, right, down.
I hit it. I don't understand it. I don't understand it at all.
Up, up, down, left, up.
Up, up, down, up.
That left, I hit it.
Down, left, down.
Right, down.
Well, we can't get anywhere in this game. Look at this.
They showed my favorite.
Where'd she go?
Ew, get away.
Oh, now I gotta get
a
my
count. A good cheerleader is not measured by the height of her jumps, but by the span of her spirit.
Wow. Okay, good time to get into... I got three more still. The next one. I should just do all three and end it because this is just fucking stupid. We'll take this out of the rotation. Good. I'm going to insert Skyrim back into it. There's nothing you can do. It's like I'm hitting these buttons and it's not registering.
Library, that reminds me.
I thought maybe it's because I'm drunk, so I took a piss and now I don't have confidence, so I got to go back and play whack-a-pole to get confidence. And it's just a never-ending circle of doing nothing. I should do a review, a YouTube essay on this fucking game. A never-ending circle of doing nothing. That's what I'll title it. Crime scene. I wonder what's at the crime scene.
What you tell I'm famous for?
Larry's room has like a little kid's decoration on it. Oh, boy. Thank you. Almost missed that one. Is that peanut butter? Uh-oh. You think that's enough? Or should I go one more? This is more interesting than what I've been doing tonight. I don't want that shit. It reverses the hands. Should be confident enough now. I jerked off 3 times in a row. Swingles. All right, once we get back in this one. Oh, wait, you're such a mashugana. See, that's Annalisa is the girl I thought was the one they gave us at Swingles. I forget her name. Coco? No, not Coco. The biker broad. But Annalisa is the Italian mafioso whatever.
Man, it's so early, yet I'm already buzzing.
Hold on. Is this the place with the springy shoes? I wonder if that'll help. Jennifer Tilly. All right, before we get into her, let's do the another Jesus Christ movie.
Going to the Mohawk Tech.
Not Coco. She was the word. Oh, wait. No, Coco was the dude, wasn't it? Coco was a dude. Okay. All right. Back to the Holy Sabado Easter Spectacular. Number three is The Last Temptation of Christ. And if you want something that's was controversial, this is the movie for you. Right off the bat, there's a disclaimer at the beginning of this movie, pretty much a disclaimer that this is a work of fiction. It's not based off the Gospels, blah, blah, blah. Basically, Martin Scorsese's way is saying, hey, I'm just trying to make a movie here about something semi-interesting. It's fiction. It's not real. And it's not meant to bash Jesus Christ or anything. I bet you the studio made him put that in there at the beginning. But it's basically covering his ass or something. And it also basically tells you what the movie's about. The disclaimer, it says, hey, this is, I forget. It has an excerpt from the book that this movie's based off of. But it basically tells you that this is a battle between the soul and the body. Or no, the soul's the battleground between the body and the mind or something like that. It basically tells you what the movie's going to be about. So, I found this movie very confusing, too. But let's go ahead and a quick synopsis. Jesus is like, it's the story of Jesus, but it focuses on like his human nature and not his godly nature. And it's basically with Jesus struggling to be human and, but it goes through like most of his ministry, but things are like, totally different, you know, than all those Jesus stories you hear about his ministry and stuff. And then it gets up to the crucifixion and then something crazy happens during the crucifixion and, so it's like Jesus's life, but it's told from his human perspective, or it's trying to bring out his human perspective, how he suffers, how he struggles with decisions, how he sins, which, you know, from the Bible, Jesus was without sin, but they put sin, you know, Jesus seems like a sinner in this movie. It's a bit confusing. I've always thought that about this movie. I watched it even when I first watched it, and then I watched it again last night. And I don't know if Jesus is actually sinning in this movie or they're just making it look like he sins, that he's to make him look more human. There's some weird, I don't know if the timeline's jumbled in this movie. It's really hard to follow for the first half of it. And again, this is an almost 3-hour long movie too. And they call it The Last Temptation of Christ, and he eventually gets into the desert and is tempted by the devil. And here's what I don't get. He's struggling, before he goes, gets tempted, like right before, he's talking with Judas, and he's struggling with whether he should be militant or like preach from the heart and about loving your neighbor and stuff like that. So it's either the sword or be gentle. You know, he's struggling with which way to go, which way to preach, you know, start his ministry and all that. Should I be tough and militant, or should I be soft and loving and caring and stuff like that? And he goes to the desert and gets tempted. And he tells God to tell him which way to go, how to do this. And it ends up he's he goes the militant way. He gets a sword or an axe or something like that. And then he preaches that way. Like, he's very militant and very, you know, strong, and Rome is bad and stuff like that. You know, it's, but that's not, I don't understand, like, he chooses that, but that's not what Jesus chose. That, so I don't understand what they're going for here. And that's not even the controversial part of this movie, according to sources I read. The controversial part of this movie is the ending of this movie. But I thought that was pretty controversial because I'm like, Jesus didn't choose to preach that way. He chose to be loving and caring and preach loving and caring and all that stuff. So I don't understand why that wasn't controversial. Maybe it was. It's just they didn't pick up on that in the sources I read or stuff like that. But, yeah, I always thought that was kind of confusing. I'm like, wait, so did he get tempted and chose the wrong way? That could be, but that's not what the movie says. In fact, the final the last temptation of Christ happens on the cross. So everything he did before then was the way to go, or I don't know. Maybe somebody has a different interpretation of that. It just seems weird, seems jumbled. So anyways, a few other things, that were interesting. When he's in the desert and he gets tempted, first the devil appears, or Satan appears, or Lucifer, whoever you want to call him, Beelzebub, appears as a snake, and then it appears as a lion, and then it appears as fire. Now, fire, which seems to be like, you know, kind of like the burning bush with Moses, and the fire one actually is the one that tells him to pick up the axe, and so, yeah. I mean, as far as my interpretation goes, he fell for that temptation. That was the devil's third trick. That wasn't God talking to him. He fell for that one, and he chose to take up the axe. So that could be, but the movie doesn't tell you that anywhere in the rest of the movie. Like, oh, you were wrong about that. So I don't know. It seems like he got tempted, and he fell for that temptation. But anyways, the movie continues on. He's more militant, and but when it comes to actually rising up against Rome, he goes up there and they're like, hey, let's take him on, let's take the soldiers on. He's got a big gaggle of following behind him, and he can't do it. So they end up getting arrested and crucified. And then him and Judas play, oh, I forgot to mention, Willem Dafoe, obviously, the Green Goblin, plays Jesus, and Harvey Keitel, Mr. White, or whatever, plays Judas, and he's really out of place. He doesn't even belong. It's just, like, weird to see Harvey Keitel as Judas. But there's an interesting conversation right before he gets arrested with between Judas and Jesus, and I thought it was very profound. The Bible portrays, and all these movies usually portray, as Judas being the what do you call it? The betrayer, obviously. But in this movie, it's almost like a scheme that Jesus plays with Judas and with Judas's cooperation. And Jesus says, all I have to do is die. You have to make your job is harder. You have to turn me in. So he's talking about, you know, his best friend, you know, you have to turn me in. All I have to do is die, and your job is much harder. And I thought that was pretty profound. That's a different take on the whole Judas thing. Usually Judas just sells Jesus out, you know. But this one, they collaborate, and it's like, the only way to get God's will done is for me to be arrested. You need to turn me in. I thought that was pretty crazy, and I thought that was pretty original. You know, it's not what I believe, but, you know, I thought it was a pretty cool, pretty profound interpretation of that. Let's see, who else? While we're talking about characters in the movie, David Bowie is Pontius Pilate in this movie. I forgot about that. I remember it dawned on me when I saw it. I was like, is that David Bowie? And then I checked the credits real quick. I was like, yeah, it was David Bowie. I was like, yeah, he does a good Pontius Pilate. In fact, all the Romans in this movie have British accents. And then all the Jews have New York accents. Like, Scorsese purposely did that for some reason. I didn't read too much in depth of it, but I did get that from IMDb. All the Jews have American accents, and then all the apostles on top of that have New York accents. So I thought that was kind of interesting. I don't know what the point of that is. It's kind of like the Empire's all British in Star Wars and stuff like that. So, that was pretty interesting. There was some confusing shit with Mary Magdalene in this movie, too. Like, in the beginning, Jesus asked Mary Magdalene for forgiveness. I guess for not sleeping with her or not marrying her or... I don't know. Like, she came on to him and he told her no, and then he asked forgiveness for it. But before that, he sits there and watches her bang like 8 guys during the day, and then she puts the no vacancy sign out and Jesus asks her for forgiveness, and then she tempts Jesus. She like takes her top off and Barbara Hershey and Jesus declines to go up Barbara Hershey's highway. So yeah, I could see like this movie was trying to be controversial, to be controversial, you know. It doesn't seem like you would include something like that unless you were trying to push the envelope, which is probably what Scorsese and the author of the book were going for. They wanted to push the envelope. The book is much older. The book is from the 50s. This movie's from the 80s, I believe 88 or 85 or something like that. And so let's get to the big controversy. Why this movie, most people had a problem with this movie, or most churches and most churches, I for lack of a better word, had a problem with this movie. And it's the fact that on the cross, Jesus is dying and an angel appears to him and says, God sent me to save you. Let's take you down from this cross. And Jesus gets down from the cross and the angel and him walk away and he doesn't die. And he ends up banging Mary Magdalene, and then God kills Mary Magdalene. And then he starts banging some other woman that he knew and has a bunch of kids with her. And then she leaves for a night and he lies down with her best friend. I don't know. It seems like he turns into a big poon hound. He turns into Leisure Suit Larry all of a sudden once he gets saved from the cross. But then he runs into Saul, who has been converted to Paul, and you're wondering, and Paul is preaching the whole story of the resurrection. And he's like puzzled. He's like, I'm right here. I'd never died. God saved me. So he pulls Saul aside and he gets in this big argument with Saul, or Paul, whatever. And he's like, Paul's like, I wouldn't tell a story about you. You're nothing. He's like, whatever I can make up is better than telling your actual story. So here Paul is making up all the stories of the resurrection and reappearing to the apostles and the Holy Spirit and everything. He's making it all up. And Jesus is like, I'm still alive. You know, I have kids and I have, and he's like, you're just worthless. You know, whatever I can make up is better than telling your actual story. So I thought that was pretty cool. But yeah, the controversy from this movie is the fact that Jesus takes that last temptation. He doesn't realize he was being tempted, at least for a while, which means being saved from the cross and being able to start a family and living a long life. And at the end of the movie, he's really old, and all the apostles, Jerusalem starts burning, and all the Rome attacks and starts killing everybody. I guess in the apostles walk in his room, he's on his deathbed, and he realizes, I only watched it 12 hours ago. I forget how he realizes it, but all of a sudden he realizes that the flame in the desert was the devil, and that the little girl that is the angel that saved him from the cross is the devil as well. And that was his last temptation, was you can either die and finish what everything started, or finish what you started with God, or you can have a long life and live. And he eventually gets put back on the cross and he says, it's finished. And then it ends with some killer Peter Gabriel fucking score for the credits. So in all that time, that 3.5 hours or almost 3 hours of the movie, Jesus ends up doing the right thing. So I don't think it could be that controversial, because in the end he says it, he's back on the cross and he says it is finished. So it was probably much ado about nothing in the long run. But the message at the very end, I mean, I feel that it's uplifting. He's dying on the cross and he says it is finished. So he did conquer the temptation. And like I said, I didn't know this, but, you know, the Peter Gabriel song is really cool at the end of it. Right after he says it, it flashes to the credits with it. And you can tell, like, once you, he doesn't sing, Peter Gabriel doesn't sing, but you can tell, he's like, that's a Peter Gabriel tune, at least, you know, and it's pretty cool. So, yeah, and then there's some other stuff, like, pushing the envelope stuff, like, Jesus was the only one in town that would carve the crosses for the Romans to crucify Jews on, and you're like, okay, I mean, this is just thrown in there just it really doesn't serve a purpose, because like the whole temptation is him on the cross getting off the cross. I don't see what the purpose is of, other than showing that Jesus is human, but there's other ways to show that without being like, oh yeah, he carved crosses to kill Jews and blah blah blah, and he asked forgiveness from Mary Magdalene because he turned her hand job down or whatever. You know, and Jesus is looking at boobies and stuff, you know. So, I don't know. I mean, it just seems like it's not Scorsese's best effort. In fact, there was a movie came out a few years ago by Scorsese that got no fanfare whatsoever, probably because of its subject matter, about Jesuit priests. And that movie is freaking awesome. I think it's called Silence. My brother told me this the other day, reminded me what it was, and I already forgot, but... yeah, I saw it once, and I thought that movie was freaking great. This movie's good. The acting is, Harvey Keitel is meh. I can't think of any other actors in this besides Bowie, and David Bowie. He does a great job, but he's only in it for 5 minutes. Willem Dafoe, it's just, I don't know. Willem Dafoe's got such a distinct face that I just don't see him as Jesus. I don't buy it, you know? I don't know what they were thinking. I just don't buy it. I don't buy it. Because they should have cast somebody else for this role. He does a decent job, though. I'm not saying he does a bad job acting or anything. I'm just saying he just doesn't look like it. Therefore, I don't buy it. And I don't know. So, if you... And I did mention Barbara Hershey's Highway and her gigantic boobs. And this brings me back to, as somebody brought up in the beginning of the stream, you should have rated it with the nip factor in there. And I'm like, there's no nip factor in Jesus movies. Well, this movie does have nip factor. It's got Barbara Hershey's big old floppy boobs. It's got native boobs, John the Baptist and his gaggle of followers in the river, and a bunch of native women boobs. This movie's got a lot of boobs. So this would have got a 5 on the nip factor, but in a 5 on the soundtrack. But other than that, there's other Scorsese movies I'd rather watch. And I read on IMDb that this sat on his desk for 5 years, and he was so worried about doing this, but he always wanted to make a movie about Jesus. And I don't know. I don't know if I buy it. I just think Scorsese was trying to be edgy for the sake of being edgy. And it doesn't really show in this movie. This movie doesn't really do much for me. I do like the fact that they're trying to explore Jesus' human side. But I just think there's better ways to go about that. And in fact, the next movie, I think, does a better job of showing the human side of Jesus than The Last Temptation of Christ. Interesting plot. Interesting. I'm even going to say that the controversial part, The Last Temptation, where he gets off the cross, is very interesting. I think that's very interesting. The rest of it's just filler and shock and awe is how I would describe it. So I wouldn't say I'm the greatest fan of this movie. It has its moments. And it was a cool premise. It's just, I don't think it was pulled off very well. But who am I to criticize? I'm just a fat guy. I'm just a fat guy named the Spicy Burrito. Who am I to criticize the fucking king, Martin Scorsese? So take my review with a grain of salt. But if you want to see something controversial and you want to see Jesus in a totally different light than what you've been taught or what you've heard, this is the movie for you. It's not for me. I'm not going to say I hated it, but yeah. And it's also long as hell and drawn out too. This movie could have been summed up in an hour and 45 minutes easily. Why the extra hour? I don't know. But this was back in the 80s. Can you imagine? Like nowadays, that's normal. Fucking 3 hour fucking long movie. What? That's fucking normal. So yeah. Check it out if you want something completely different. If you want to see Jesus as a poon hound, go right ahead and check this one out. Oh, shit. So, like I said, who am I to criticize Martin Scorsese? So forget everything I just said. All right, should we try her real quick? Then we're going to do a 1-2 punch to end the show, I guess. But remember that. Remember that fucking, as my fan blows my papers all over the desk. Remember that human aspect, and we'll talk about that in the next one. So, hey, I can't talk to you? Oh, there you go.
Let me show you why cheerleaders are simply a jump above the rest.
How cheesy of a fucking line was that? A jump above the rest. As you go head-to-head with a little up-and-down action. Everything is a fucking pun or...
Up, up, left, up.
Up, up, down, left, up.
Right, right, up, down, left, down.
Right, right, up, down, down.
Oh, I get it.
Left, 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 up, right, button, button, left.
Left, 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 up, left,
down, down, left, right, down, right, up, up, button,
down, down, left, down.
I think I just figured something out. Do you just want to wimp out and stop the pain? How do you answer that question? I think I just figured something out. I got the first few right. Okay, that last, I'm way too drunk to do that last part. I mean, that was crazy. I just got the first like 3, 4, or 5 right. I wonder if it has something to do with my confidence level. I wonder if my confidence level has been down. I'm going to have to go back and check the tape. I believe the whole night my confidence level has been 0. And that is why I'm failing all these ridiculously. I'll have to check the tape or check the manual to this game. I bet you confidence level has something to do with how you perform in these games. But a bigger question is, do I want to wimp out and stop the pain? Yeah. Oh, fuck yeah. 5 tokens. I got like 8,000 of them. Hell yeah. Look at that. I'm a fucking beast at this game. I told you I was good. I outsmarted Leisure Suit Larry Magna Cum Laude on PC. I outsmarted it. You just lose so much that you can buy your way out of it.
That was fun. So, what's up next?
What's next is I take a shower and meet my boyfriend.
Oh, I thought she was going to say take a shit.
Ooh, that's cold.
Oh, wait. Does that mean we... Can we talk to her anymore?
Hey, Larry. Sorry. Busy, busy.
Oh. Well, I don't know about that. Was that meant to happen, or is that because I gave up, is the question. These are questions I'll have to research if I'm ever going to play this again on... That broad has no ass. If I'm ever going to play this again on PC, on a stream, I need to answer these questions. Does confidence level affect your performance? And does giving up matter? So we'll check it out. I'll check it out. I'll do my research. No, I won't. So is Jesus like the original, the OG zombie? No, actually, no. Lazarus would be the OG zombie, right? Lazarus was raised from the dead before Jesus was.
Library, never mind.
But Jesus did the raising. So I would rank Jesus as the OG zombie. Way before George Romero got a hold of him. Yeah, comparing the three Jesuses we've talked about so far, I would have to say, unfortunately, I don't know the actor's name, that the Jesus in Risen is my favorite. And he doesn't even talk, I don't think. He talks for a little bit, but he smiles a lot. Max von Sydow is way too mysterious, and Willem Dafoe I already described as I don't believe him as Jesus one bit. So, yeah, I got to go with the guy I don't know his name. The Middle Eastern guy, I don't know his name so far. So, if I did a Best Jesus Award, out of those three, the guy from Risen takes the cake. And he's only in the movie for like 10 minutes. Caller on the phone, huh? Oh, no, this is actually part of the game. Okay, cool.
Call her up.
I should have played Whack-A-Pole before this.
Hello? Hello?
Hello, Barbara Jo? This is your boyfriend, Chet.
This doesn't sound like Chet.
Yes, it seems I've come down with a bit of a cold. Achoo.
Oh, I'm so sorry to hear that, sweetie. I was gonna go out tonight.
Well, Larry.
I guess I won't see you at the club then.
Yes. Perhaps.
You're blowing it.
Oh, no. Don't go there. I will not be there. The club is closed tonight, so I will not be there, nor will any other people be there, because the club is closed.
Seriously? I didn't hear anything about that. What's wrong?
What's wrong?
Come on, think of something.
I'm not allowed to tell you. It is top secret.
Come on, sweetie. You can tell me.
Mine's getting tight. Time to cut this one loose.
I just called to say I don't love you.
And
I'm engaging in sexual intercourse with your mother right now.
Harsh, Larry.
On the telephone.
That's harsh.
Ha, ha, ha. Oh, my. We got a real Hellcat in the sack here.
Oh, Chet, how could you? My friends warned me about you. I hate you forever. Go to hell.
There you go.
Larry, you sold the man down a river like that. You could have said he was just banging some whore, but her mom? Larry, come on. You can't stoop that low. Poor guy. Now what do we do with Barbara Jo? Was she at the club? He told her not to go to the club. Oh, me so horny. I'm gonna get copyright struck. Oh, me so horny. Spicy burrito so horny. Gonna get copyright struck. Uma, Oprah. Oprah, Uma. Okay. Black Book. Where's Barbara Jo now? Barbara Wetness. Okay, cool. Back to sorority.
Whipped cream.
Are you lost, ma'am? Because heaven's a long way from here.
What do you want?
I could use some more booze.
Oh, you know what? No, it's probably not confidence. It's the springy shoes that I bought. The springy shoes. Duh. I'll have to check the confidence thing, though, too, because that could be... This game's way too complicated for tits and dick jokes. That's all I want. Tits and dick jokes. And farts and poop jokes. Closed for inspection on Fridays. Lefties 2. That was the original bar Leisure Suit Larry 1 took place in. Or at least the beginning of it. Okay. Yeah. Okay. Well, we got to stop and talk about the next one. Well, let me make some money first. I'm going to go a whole stream without getting one token of affection. And I think I decided I'm going to stop censoring this stream. Fuck it. Like YouTube's going to mess with somebody who has 5 viewers. Unless they show Larry's dong, then I'll censor it because nobody wants to see Larry's dong. I tried. I didn't know that was coming up. Sorry about that. Next time I'll do better on censoring Larry's dong. That one broad though earlier had you probably caught a glimpse of it because I wasn't that quick on the censor button, but she had a nice bush. This is bullshit. I want bush. Pan down. We've got bush. We've got bush. Oh, it's not letting me evaluate, or it already did. Okay.
Better believe I am.
Let's do one more round.
I am not speaking to you.
Anybody going through epileptic shocks out there? That's nothing to joke about. Much. All right, $26. That should do it. We could take out abroad on a night on the town with $26 in our pocket. Hell yeah. Is that Louis C.K.? Or the guy Ricky from Trailer Park Boys? Kind of looks like him. It's a mixture of both. I've done them both. Take her out on a hot date. Watch me struggle with this one. God, she got some big boobs.
Hey, Barbara Jo, how about a drink?
No, thanks, Larry. I'm not really in the mood.
The last name's Bimbo.
Oh, come on, it'll be fun. I know a great place.
Okay.
Barbara Jo Bimbo. Yeah, hooray for boobies, definitely. Who wants boobies? He took her to Lefties. Oh, my God.
Where did you take me? Yuck. Everybody here is, like, poor and ugly and stuff.
Ladies, are you ready to get wet? I hope so, because Lefties 2 is proud to present its third annual Hooter Soak. Contestants, please file up next to the bar.
Me, 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 me.
Yes. Her.
Lucky man with the dead rat floating in his beer.
Hey, that's me.
You're tonight's water boy.
Yee-hee!
Oh, this I can already see this is going to be a complete freaking struggle. Hopefully it's as easy as that first water game. Girls' School by I think it's Faster Pussycat. fucking great tune. Oh, you bitch. Barber Joe. Come back here, honey. Now, why aren't all the games that easy? Hey, Uncle Larry.
That was fun.
Yeah.
I like the part with the water.
Yes, water.
You don't think anybody, like, saw my boobs, do you?
No, no.
Yes,
yes, boobs. Yes, boobs. Oh, jeez. At the girls' school.
Dwight.
What's up, Uncle Larry?
Did I ever tell you about the time I went to the grocery store? Don't worry, nephew. When your Uncle Larry goes, don't think he's forgotten about you. I left you two of my most prized possessions. My Barry Manilow A-tracks and my 1970 Volkswagen Beetle.
Mmm. Very nice. Where did she run off to? It's where dumb chicks live and ends in aurority. Come on, we could have wrote a better joke than that, but it can't all be good. One token of affection would be nice. Barbara Joe had to go change her top. It was a little wet. Oh, boy. At the girls' school. This song, this game does have an awesome soundtrack. They had Slaughter in the frat house, Motley Crue's the opening song. Then they got Me So Horny and what's the other one? I don't know. Decent, a very good soundtrack.
Hey, it's us. Walnut Log is here.
Okay, so things are going perfectly with BJ, but you've still got some tricks up your sleeve.
What's wrong?
Oh, Larry, I'm like so mad right now. I don't know what to do.
I'm sorry to hear that. What happened?
It's my boyfriend, Larry. Or should I say ex-boyfriend. That total a-hole. So it turns out that call I got the other day was like a total prank. Ugh, whatever. Anyway, so I confront Chet about it, and I catch him in bed with Estelle Barfus. Oh, Estelle
Getty?
Yuck. Like, it is so over.
Barbara Joe, you sound so full of anger. And anger is only one letter away from danger. Now, tell me what's wrong.
Thanks, Larry, but I so do not want to talk about it right now. And no offense, Larry, but... especially not with you.
Well, if you don't want to talk to me, maybe you'll feel more comfortable talking to my friend here, Timmy the Turtle.
Hey, Barbara Joe, you look sad. Why don't you bend over and Timmy will make it all better.
Man, those farts are punishing.
You cannot be serious.
It's time to accept your feelings. Say to yourself, I am sad. I am frightened. I am angry. It's all right to have feelings. We all have feelings, even turtles.
Yeah, Timmy, whatever.
I don't know, Timmy. Barbara Jo still looks sad.
What the hell?
She sure is, Rhonda.
You know, it helps me when I feel that way. A story.
Gee, Rhonda,
That's a super idea.
Ooh, a story. Fun.
Hey, Rhonda, you look sad. What's wrong?
Yesterday on the playground, Max was playing magic sticks with Eunice.
That doesn't sound so bad, Rhonda.
Oh my god, I used to totally play that game. Magic sticks was like so fun.
But Max is my friend.
Well, I can be your friend too, Rhonda. Then we can play magic sticks.
Really? You'd be my friend?
Of course, Barbara Jar, Rhonda.
Wait. Oh, that sounds like fun. But later, Timmy, where are we going to find sticks?
I got your magic stick right here, baby.
Oh, Timmy.
Oh, you gotta be kidding me.
I think I'll leave you three alone.
Very end. Very fucking end. We'll try one more time.
What's wrong?
Oh, Larry, I'm, like, so mad right now. I don't know what to do.
I'm sorry to hear that. What happened?
It's my boyfriend, Larry. Or should I say ex-boyfriend. That total a-hole. So it turns out that call I got the other day was, like, a total prank. Ugh, whatever. Anyway, so I confront Chet about it, and I catch him in bed with Estelle Barfus.
Getty.
Ugh, Estelle Getty. Barfus. Yuck. Like... it is so over.
Barbara Jo, you sound so full of anger. And anger is only one letter away from danger. If you need to, lay your head on my shoulder. Talk to me.
Thanks, Larry, but I so do not want to talk about it right now. And no offense, Larry, but especially not with you.
Well, if you don't want to talk to me, maybe you'll feel more comfortable talking to my friend here. Timmy the Turtle.
Hey, Barbara Joe, you look sad. Why don't you bend over and Timmy will make it all better.
You cannot be serious.
It's time to accept your feelings. Say to yourself, I want Larry. I need him. I need him inside me.
It's all right to have feelings. We all have feelings. Even turtles.
Yeah. Timmy, whatever.
I don't know, Timmy. Barbara Jo still looks sad.
She sure is, Rhonda.
You know what helps me when I feel that way? A story.
Gee, Rhonda, that's a super idea.
Ooh, a story. Fun.
Hey, Rhonda, you look sad. What's wrong?
Yesterday on the playground, Max was playing magic sticks with Eunice.
Uh-oh. The game froze. You gotta be kidding me. Well, I guess if there's any time than now to bring up this topic. Oh, shit. Okay. Little technical difficulties there, but that's all right because we are way behind. I got 30 minutes to squeeze in two topics here. I'm just seeing if I can actually shut this down or not. It won't let me shut it down. So, all right, we're stuck. We're done. Let's turn off the audio on that one. Okay. Number two, without further ado, is The Passion of the Christ. This is a, okay. I kind of have mixed feelings about this movie. One hand, I think it's freaking awesome. And then the other hand, it's like, maybe it's a bit too brutal. I don't know. Of course, this is directed by Mel Gibson, who's you see up there, the famous Mel Gibson. This is the actual Friday night story. The story of this is basically just the passion, the stages of the cross, basically. No resurrection, no ministry, no birth. Nothing. Some of that stuff is dotted in there and it's dotted in flashbacks, but it's basically telling the passion. This is a very realistic take in more ways than one, not just the violence and the blood and gore and guts and stuff like that, but this is actually, also all subtitled and they speak Aramaic and Latin throughout the whole movie. So if you didn't know that, everybody knows that, but I just thought that was pretty crazy how they went to that much detail to get the actors all to speak Aramaic and Latin, which is a dead language. So, yeah. So that's adds to the realism. This movie's freaking brutal. Like, and for those of you who haven't seen it, if you haven't seen it, you gotta watch it. But it is freaking brutal. I mean, I've never seen so much violence. And like Mel Gibson movies, you know, he likes to beat the shit out of the British in Braveheart, and then again in The Patriot. And I always thought those were pretty violent movies, but this one takes the cake, and it's and all the violence is against one man. Yeah, I mean, at some point they whip him. And I was always taught in school that you could only whip somebody 39 times. If you whipped them 40, then you get whipped yourself. I don't know if that's true or not, but a lot of the Jesus movies, they only whip them 40 times. This one, it seems like they whip him like fucking 80 times. And not only just his back, they're whipping his front. They're whipping his legs, his feet, his face. They're just tearing flesh left and right. And it's so brutal. And like I was saying, it's like realistic violence. But in the long run, I think Jesus would have died of loss of blood before he even got out of Pilate's house. Like, that's how bloody it is and how much how brutal they treat him. let's see. In this movie, Mel was obviously getting... The whole point of this movie was to get the suffering that Jesus undertook for us to the forefront. And that's the whole story of Jesus, right? He suffered and died for our sins, if you're part of the Christian religion. If you buy into the Christian faith, Jesus suffered, died for our sins. And he brings that suffering to the fucking forefront. Now, Mel Gibson is Catholic. I am Catholic. So growing up, and Catholics have this, more than the other religions, are known for celebrating the suffering of Jesus. You know, more than Lutherans and all the Protestant religions. And they focus there. That's one of the criticisms of the Catholic Church, is they focus too much on the suffering of Jesus Christ. And you can tell Mel was a Catholic because, man, they focus in on the suffering like crazy. And that also shows Jesus's human side, that he had to suffer and how much painful. And every whip, you just feel it yourself. That's what I feel with this movie. Like, oh, man, that's brutal. Can you imagine being in those shoes or sandals in Jesus' case? He wasn't wearing Nikes out there, I doubt. Yeah, so so Mel definitely brings the suffering to the forefront. His ministry and his lessons and stuff are in the background, which and how they do that is they do it through flashbacks, like I mentioned earlier. So it may be a bit over the top. In fact, it is over the top. But if you're a Catholic, you were raised on that stuff. So, for me, it isn't that over the top, but I can see how other viewers of this be like, geez, that is brutal. Let's see. In this movie, Jim Caviezel plays Jesus, and Jesus seems bulky and like brutish. I have no other better way of describing it. He just seems like a big dude. And maybe that's what they're going for, to take all that punishment. He needed to be a big, muscular dude. Although when they strip him of his clothes and put him on the cross, he looks real skinny. But throughout the movie, he's wearing like robes and stuff, and it makes him look like a big brute, you know. And he's taller than everybody else. So, yeah, I can see it. The carrying of the cross is brutal, too. Just like... the amount of energy he did not have, but he made it there, you know, and he accomplished his goal. Okay, there was some controversy with this movie as well. Not as much as Last Temptation of Christ, I would be willing to bet. But the controversy about this one was that it was anti-Semitic. Don't buy that bullshit. Do not buy that bullshit. This movie is not anti-Semitic. And in fact, I'll do you one better. I believe Mel Gibson portrays the Romans worse than the Jews. So if anything, it portrays everybody in the movie terribly. It's not singling out, you know, Jews and being anti-Semitic. Don't buy that Hollywood bullshit propaganda. This movie portrays the Romans just as bad, if not worse, than the Jews. So I never saw it, and I never saw the whole anti-Semitic trope. I mean, it's telling the story of the Bible. So how come other movies that tell the Jesus story don't get in trouble for being anti-Semitic? I mean, it was the Jews that crucified him with the Romans' help. But yeah, the Romans are fucking terrible in this movie. Like the guards, they are brutal. They enjoy it too much. And not one of them is remorseful. I think there's one guy at the end that seems remorseful when he tries to give Jesus some water and a sponge on the cross. Other than that, these fuckers are nasty, nasty motherfuckers. And they're joking around, and it's like they're taking pleasure out of what they're doing. Yeah, don't let them kid you. They make the Romans look really fucking brutal in this movie as well. So I think that anti-Semitism was a little overhyped when it came out. And I don't know what purpose that was for, but yeah, I just think people were mad that Mel was making a movie about Christ. And so, and they just wanted something to complain about. So yeah, don't buy that bullshit. Like I said, it might be a bit over the top, but it reminds us the ultimate lesson of how one man, if you believe in Christ, how he suffered for our sins, and he does suffer in this movie. Jim Caviezel does a good job. There's 2 points in this. Jim Caviezel does a great job portraying the suffering and dying on the cross. I think he does a phenomenal job. Like his breathing, he could barely talk. He's covered in blood. Just all the motions he makes, the shaking, and what really gets to you is like the breathing, though, his labored breathing and stuff. And he does a fucking phenomenal job portraying the suffering. On the other hand, Mel deciding to make this movie in Aramaic and Latin. And I'm not going to single out Caviezel, but everybody, all the actors, just, it doesn't seem right. They just act like the dialogue's really slow because it's not their first language. It just doesn't seem realistic. It makes the acting look drawn out and slow. I don't know how to describe it. Everybody just speaks really slowly, and it just feels sloppy. That's got to be either because the language, you're not used to hearing the language, or the fact that the language is really slow, which I don't know, or the fact that the actors that's not their first language, so they were slowly speaking in to get it pronounced right and stuff like that. So it just doesn't, I don't think it works. I think this movie would have been better in English. And then maybe an option for, I guess you couldn't do that. This movie's old, too. I didn't realize that this came out in 2004. That's a long time ago. I didn't realize that. I thought it was maybe 15 years ago or something. But, well, it's almost 17, 18 years. So, yeah, it's crazy. I didn't realize how old it was. Seems like yesterday when I saw it for the first time. And I own this movie, so I highly, highly recommend it. If you're turned off by blood and gore, I guess I wouldn't recommend it. But if you want to see a better portrayal of Jesus' suffering than what was in Last Temptation of Christ, this is the movie for you. There's nothing thought-provoking about this, really. There's no fancy schmancy lessons or what-ifs like Last Temptation of Christ, you know. This is just straight up, boom, in your face. You know, we're going to tell the Passion of the Christ, the Catholic way, and he pulls it off great. And Mel Gibson's freaking awesome. I mean, what can you say about Mel Gibson? He's a stud. He's a stud, Jerry. He's a stud. And another movie by Mel Gibson is another gory one I didn't mention was Hacksaw Ridge. Check that out. That's a freaking great movie, too. Mel seems to be able to do whatever he wants in Hollywood, and nobody's going to stop him. He finds a way. And I remember they had a hard time getting funding for this movie. I remember watching Entertainment Tonight way back in the day, and they were saying how, oh, he doesn't have enough funding. And then they went on set, and everything's going crazy. And Mel finds a way. Mel will find a way to make his fucking movie the way he wants to make it. And there's nothing special in photography that stood out to me. You know, it's just Mel telling a story the way only Mel can tell a story. Which, you know, see Braveheart, see The Patriot. I don't know if he directed The Patriot, though. See this, see Hacksaw Ridge. You'll enjoy him. And I highly recommend it. Just like I said, those few off-putting points, I think could have been taken care of. One, the acting could have been taken care of if it was in English. And just like, I don't know, Jim Caviezel kind of seems wooden when it comes to his flashback scenes. Although the one flashback scene I really liked was when he's building a table and he plays around with his mom, like he jokes around with Mary. And that really did a good job of showing Jesus's human side and how Mary still treated him like a child, like her child. Even though she knew he was born for something greater, she still made him wash his hands. She's like, "You're not coming in my house all filthy. You take off that apron, wash your hands and stuff." She's still being a mother, and she's still a mother throughout the whole movie. And then of course, Mary Magdalene's beautiful, even though it seems like every scene, her and Mary, Jesus's mother, are always in black and white. I know that's not true, but it just seems that way because they're so pale and the way it's shot. It seems like those two are in black and white and everybody else is in color. That's just the way it is. But, of course, it's Monica Bellucci. No nip factor in this unless you count Jim Caviezel's nips. And there's no resurrection in this. There is a resurrection in it. They show it. But there's no, like, long, drawn-out story. It's, like, a 30-second shot of him sitting in his tomb. He gets up naked as the day he was born, but he has holes in his hands, and he starts walking, and he's like, "Let's fucking do this. Let's roll to Passion of the Christ Part 2, The Acts of the Apostles," or some shit like that. Wouldn't it be great if Mel came back for Part 2? I think that's... Oh, I think I hit on all the major points I wanted to hit on. But yeah, if you haven't seen it, to watch it just to see the amount of brutalness that Jesus went through in that suffering that he did. I forgot. The creepy kids, the creepy fucking kids. Oh my God. This movie has the two kids that like fucking tease Judas after Judas like does his thing and betrays Jesus. And they got like these old man faces. They're the creepiest looking fucking kids ever. And then I thought Satan's or Lucifer Beelzebub's portrayal, I found that to be interesting too, because he chose like an actor. He chose to make him like, what's the word? Androgynous? Like no sex? Like asexual? No. Androgynous, right? Like neither male nor female. It's like you're guessing. Almost like the Prometheus. It reminds me of the Prometheus aliens. Not the aliens, but the creators guys or whatever they call them. And just in a hood. You know, it's one of those Prometheus guys in a hood. And then one thing I didn't mention was after he dies, the temple cracks in half. And you don't see that portrayed very often. You see lightning and a storm come in. But in this one, they portrayed the temple cracking in half. So I thought that was pretty cool. But yeah, I mean, check it out. Passion of the Christ, the ultimate the ultimate Easter movie. There you go. There you have it. We got 13 minutes. This is perfect. Thank God the game crashed because I might have been running late. Let's bring up the last movie I watched. And I rated... by the way, I know it's a little too late, but I listed these movies in the order I watched them. So it has nothing to do with what I like the best and what I like the most. So number one, this is the one I like the most, though, and that's why I saved it for last. Jesus Christ Superstar. Uh-oh, Mel's still up. There he goes. Okay, Mel wanted to hone in on Ted Neely there. Yeah, Jesus Christ Superstar. I mean, what can he say about this movie? It is probably my favorite telling of Christ's story of all time. And it probably has to do with the fact that I'm a big musical fan. So, yeah, this is a musical telling of Jesus's life. Obviously, Andrew Lloyd Webber. This one starts from Jesus's ministry up into the resurrection. So there's no birth in this or anything. No three wise men. This is a very clever musical. The lyrics in this musical are great. Tim Rice, who's a lyric legend. But this movie is crazy. There's so much weird stuff going on. First of all, hippies. Fucking hippies in this movie. It's like a play put on by a bunch of hippies. So there's bell bottoms and crazy hair and chicks with hairy pits and everything, man. This movie's got everything. Hairy pits. I'm about big 70s bush. No, I'm just joking. You don't see any bush in this movie. But so just a gaggle of hippies that put on the passion play. And a lot of this is you got the two main characters, interesting choice. It's kind of like Last Temptation of Christ, although this is way before Last Temptation of Christ. They choose Judas to be the main character with Jesus, of course. And a lot of this movie takes place, this musical movie slash movie musical, takes place from Judas's perspective. There's a couple of things that I've always been weirded out about. One of them is like Mary Magdalene has this weird, comfortable relationship or uncomfortable relationship with Jesus. Like there's a scene where she washes him down and he's like, that's good and stuff like that. And then she has a love song about him, which I guess you got to have a musical with a love song. You can't have a musical with a love song. So they figured they should have a song with Mary Magdalene. Is in love with Jesus, but she knows he's meant for something more, so it'll never happen. I guess that's how you can pass it off. And then, so I always felt that the relationship between Mary Magdalene, they took a little liberties there. I don't think they were banging or anything, but this movie, there's subtle hints to it. I mean, nothing explicit, but just subtle hints. Excuse me. Judas is good in the movie. And I'm talking about the movie version of this. I'm not talking about the Broadway soundtrack or the original soundtrack. The Judas in this is good. It's Carl something. I don't know his name offhand. But he ain't no fucking Murray Head. No one is fucking Murray Head. Murray Head fucking dominated the role of Judas in the original Broadway cast recording. Check it out. Murray Head's any Judas song, check it out. Murray Head's freaking awesome. You know Murray Head, he's the guy from One Night in Bangkok. Makes a hard man humble. Get Thai, you're talking to a tourist. So he made a living in the musical business. He's been in everything. I think he played the Phantom once. And yeah, so Murray Head just nails it. But what I really want to talk about when it comes to the voices and the soundtrack of this movie is Jesus himself, played by Ted Neely. Growing up, my brothers would say he was played by Ted Nugent. But no, it's Ted Neely. And this guy is a dead ringer. His voice is a dead fucking ringer for Blood, Sweat, and Tears lead singer. Listen to Ride the Painted Pony, Let the Spin and Whirl, whatever. You know, listen to a Blood, Sweat, and Tears song and then watch this movie. You're like, oh my God, it's a spitting fucking image. It's like their voices were separated at birth. I bet you they look alike too. I haven't researched that. But oh my God, total Blood, Sweat, and Tears. And this guy can fucking belt out a fucking tune. I don't know how this guy didn't end up in a rock band at some point. He's got some pipes on him where in the Garden of Gethsemane, my favorite song on the whole soundtrack of this movie and favorite scene of the movie too. He can belt out those fucking high notes and he holds them long and it's like almost Jeff Tate. Amazing, you know. I don't know how this guy, I know he's still, when I checked like 4 years ago, he's still playing Jesus in a traveling show of this. The guy's got to be 60 freaking years old, 65 years old. He's still playing a 33-year-old Jesus. So obviously his voice hasn't gone anywhere. And there's a good YouTube video of him from a few years ago and the Garden of Gethsemane song, and he still has it. He still fucking has it. Yeah, but he's totally ride the painted pony, let the spinning wheel turn. Caiaphas, the high priest. Oh, I get a kick out of the high priest in this fucking movie. They got Taj Mahal hats. Like, their hats look like the Taj Mahal. Like, one of them's got a big fat one, one's got a tall, skinny one. The Taj Mahal hats. But Caiaphas is a dead ringer for Lyle Azedo, but he's got fucking such a low voice. Like, he's the bass, I guess. Is that the lowest? I don't know anything about musical and vocals. But his voice is so deep and so low. I bet you that guy stuffs his nuts in his fucking tube socks as they hang so low. Oh, shit. Yeah, he definitely keeps his nuts in his tube socks. Yeah, I mentioned the... Oh, yeah. And the high priest, not only do they have Taj Mahal hats, they have, like, He-Man breastplates. You got to check it out. He-Man breastplates. But and then Simon looks like the guy from Thin Lizzy. He looks like the lead singer of Thin Lizzy. It's like they just got a bunch of, like, Lyle Azedo, Thin Lizzy, Ted Nugent. I mean, all these guys are dead ringers for each other. That's crazy. Another thing about this movie I enjoy, and like I said earlier, I like stuff from the Romans' perspective. I'm always looking into if Caesar Augustus knew what was going on in Jerusalem at that time. There isn't definitive answers on all how the Romans actually reacted to Jesus. There aren't definitive answers. There are some historians that note Jesus and that Jesus was real. But I'm always interested in the Roman stuff. And in this movie, they go in depth. And I didn't mention this, but they do it in The Passion as well. Passion of the Christ. They go in depth to Pontius Pilate and his struggles with condemning Jesus, you know, putting him to death. And The Passion even goes as far as to bring the wife in, which is the actual Bible tale, which is the actual gospel. The wife actually has a dream, or the wife tells Pilate not to kill him. Pilate does have a dream that he figures that he shouldn't kill Jesus. And I just love how they show that struggle. And there's a very good song about that in this movie that Pontius Pilate delivers. And of course, my favorite. My favorite scene from the movie is the King Herod scene, and I played that earlier, or I played that at the beginning of the stream. So yeah, that's like the funniest thing ever about big fat guy. That's the way Herod should be portrayed. Now on Broadway, they portrayed him as Elvis. You know, the king, Elvis, and they do that in musicals way too often. That's why I liked with the way they took this one. They portrayed Herod as Herod is, like a big fat slob. And they got the revolting blob to do it. The guy from Billy Madison, P.S. I'm horny guy, his name's Josh Mandel, and he plays Herod in this. And he's got this like goofy voice and his big fat gut hanging out throughout the movie. And I always loved it. In fact, I played Herod in the Passion play. That's another thing. They always in school they always get the fat kid to play Herod. I think my brother. One of my brothers played Herod, and I played Herod. Of course, we were both fat kids. So, and the other one would have, I bet you, but he was on vacation. So, he wasn't around for the Passion play. So, I based my whole act on King Herod from this movie. And that was the one thing I starred in that I was good at. And everybody applauded my performance as King Herod. I didn't take my shirt off. I was in eighth grade. I was a little shy then. So, yeah, the Herod thing here. And, of course, this portrays everything about Jesus, how spiritual he was. But it does do a very focus in on his human side as well. It's a good balance. Great tunes, great guitar work in this musical. I feel like I'm not doing it justice, but, I mean, there's only so much I could say without people like checking it out for themselves. If you get past the hip cheesy hippie factor, this is a very good Passion play. And of course, Jesus Christ Superstar, the title song, is freaking phenomenal. That's after Judas dies and Jesus is carrying the cross. And Judas is like telling him, I told you so, you know, but in an uplifting kind of fucking way, you know. God, I hope I'm not missing anything. Simon, the guy who looks like from Thin Lizzy, just a fun note, he has like a convulsion on camera. He just goes, starts speaking in tongues and shit. And of course, just, you know, this doesn't go into the resurrection. In fact, I believe it's kind of weird. They put on the play, the hippies put on the passion play, and everybody gets on the bus but Jesus. Like, they pack up, they take their costumes off, pack up, get on the bus, and leave. Except Jesus is not there. So was it real? Or was it just a bunch of hippies doing drugs in the desert? Oh, and another thing I didn't mention was another thing I always got a kick out of, especially when I was a kid. Now I understand why they did it, or at least I think I understand why they did it. But the Romans carry around, like, fucking machine guns and with them. And they're all in purple shirts, too. Purple wife beaters. But yeah, I always thought that was funny that as a kid, they carried around machine guns. I think at the time when this was made in the 70s that it was supposed to represent how the Romans were so fascist, and it was supposed to bring like a present day kind of feel to it. But yeah, it's just weird seeing something in the desert, and it's supposed to be a story from 0 AD and the Romans are carrying fucking machine guns, and I believe there's tanks in it too. I might have looked down when the tanks came on, but yeah, I believe there's a couple tanks in it too. But that's probably just, you know, just Hollywood and Broadway getting their jabs in at all the fascists out there. So check this out. My favorite. This one I can't recommend enough. This is my favorite. I've watched this movie, 1,000 times. Not that many, but at least 30 times. And I've listened to it multiple more times than that. And I always come back to the movie's soundtrack and not the Broadway soundtrack, except with one exception, to listen to the Murray Head tracks on the original soundtrack. Even though the original soundtrack also has Ian Gillan, who's a rock star, plays Jesus. So he does a great job, but not as good as fucking Mr. Blood, Sweat, and Tears over here. That's for sure. Holy shit. So that is all. And I just want to apologize for all the struggling tonight, the game. And then the ultimate kick in the crotch, tonight was not only did I struggle trying to do anything in this fucking game, then the game crashes on me, but luckily it crashed at the right time because I would have never got those two in. And I felt like I had to hurry them anyways, but still, for the two people watching tonight, I apologize for the shitty game. And next time, if I play this, I'm going to prepare. And if I can't do it, we might have to stop. But I can always bring in a different game. But I'll try my best to prepare and maybe build up a purse of $1,000 so I don't have to look for money and then try to get a controller for this game. We'll see. Thanks for hanging in there. Unfortunately, Leisure Suit Larry Magna Cum Laude did not hang in there. They decided they wanted a break, and they decided to crash the game on me. But like I said, it's fine. Maybe Jesus did it. Maybe it's a sign from God. Marty, stop playing games with pussies and dicks in it. Maybe, maybe not. But anyways, that's it. Saturday's over. Sabado's over. I want to thank you all for watching. Happy Easter to all you Easter worshipers. They call them Easter worshipers in the media because for some reason we can't use the word Christian anymore. So all you Christians out there, we will use it on the Spicy Burrito channel. I'll tell you that much. All you Christians out there, all you that agnostics that have faith, happy Easter to you all. It is officially Easter, and I've rambled on enough. So without further ado, good night. Bitches.